talk about a critical but often overlooked aspect of disaster recovery and health sustainment. What I'd like us to think about first, though, is what is leadership? The answer to that is the opening of the question, leadership in crisis. And I'd like to offer three ideas. Influence, vision, and recovery. Influence. During a crisis, a leader will influence those around them to maximize their efforts in order to achieve goals and accomplish a mission. And they will do so in an environment of ambiguity, confusion, and under extremes of stress. Vision. A leader is always aware during a crisis of what's going on in the present, but holds a vision of where it is that we need to get to, even when all around them are losing the ability to see the environment. And recovery. The decisions that leaders make during crisis impact how, when, and the extent to which communities ultimately recover. These are critical issues in leadership and disasters. I'm looking forward to our discussions today about these and other central issues, how leaders sustain our communities in times of crisis.
Thank you, and welcome. I'm Tom Kirsch, I'm the director of the National Center for Disaster Medicine and Public Health. And I want to welcome you all to our second crisis leadership meeting. We had one last year which focused more on the mechanics of crisis leadership, but today we're focusing more on the mental aspects of it. And just a brief background on the National Center, because I think it's important to let you know about it. National Center is an interagency organization that's housed here at the Uniformed Services University and kind of acts in the interspace of a number of functions. We act across multiple different federal agencies. We've got partnerships with HHS, DOT, DHS, the VA, as well as being housed in the DOD. And we're also half academic and half federal. I came from a 25-year career of academia, and now we work in a space between academic institutions, between the federal government. It's kind of interesting. To me, this conference is very important. Last year's conference, I learned a lot, personally. I have been, in my past, a disaster responder, both as a leader in a leadership role, but also in a responder role as a worker bee. And I realized how important this concept of mental health and stress and the emotional aspects of response are, because, frankly, I've struggled with those things both in events and for long periods afterwards. And so I think for those of us who have been involved in these things, this is a topic near and dear to our hearts, but it's also a topic that any leader in any situation can learn from, because we do have to deal both with our own emotional responses and stresses and those of the people who report to it. So I think this is a valuable topic to learn. And again, welcome you for coming.
Thank you, Tom. And thanks for the opportunity to be here today, Admiral, Dean, distinguished guests, fellow faculty members, uniformed and civilian. It's really a pleasure to be a part of this. My name is Eric Schoonmaker, and I'm privileged to be one of the senior leaders of an effort here at the university to develop leaders and a culture of leadership. We're very, very pleased to be in partnership with the Center for Traumatic Stress and the National Center for Disaster Medicine and Public Health to bring together this nexus of thinking. I'm going to take this in a slightly different direction and make this a personal, probably some personal with you, because this is highly personal. Right? I think you have a label of thought perhaps about the dimension of the personal. I'm a career military medical officer, retired and now professor here at the university. In the early 80s, when I was assistant chief of medicine over at the Walter Reed Classic, as we call it now, before we combined with the new Walter Reed National Military Medical Center and so forth, single day in the winter, the Air Florida jet struck the 14th Street Bridge. On the same day that Metro had its first fatal crash. And those of us in a major medical center of uniform in the district began to think about, what are we going to do to respond if we have these? About 5 years later, I was transferred to Europe. And shortly after I arrived, an Italian jet in a formation at a air show at Ramstein Air Base on Flugbog, it was known there, the day of flight, went into the crowd, killed 60 people on the ground, and severely burned and injured about 300 others. Lonsdale, our Army Regional Medical Center at the time, now again a national treasure for all services, is about 3 kilometers away. And in the course of about 30 minutes, they took 180 or more casualties, severe burns, and successfully triaged them and began treatment. In 1989, I got on a plane and I flew back to a medical meeting that I was going to attend in San Francisco. And I landed at the airport in San Francisco an hour before the earthquake struck in 1989 and dropped the open bridge. I ended up going down the lot through a Letterman Army Medical Center. In the last cab, I could get out of the airport after having triaged anybody within the airport with a policeman to see if anybody was injured. And of course, we knew in the airport, although there were a lot of people rolling around on the ground, most of those were Californians who never thought that California would fall into the sea. In 1990, after Kuwait was invaded by Saddam, and we were preparing to get in Lonsdale, I was tied at Lonsdale. The Air Force had an unfortunate crash, one of the few crashes of a C-5 at Ramstein. And I was one of only 3 docs as the chief physician in the hospital to arrive at the emergency room, along with my commander, who was a nuclear medicine doc, and one emergency medicine doc. And we triaged and managed about 20 casualties, including several that died in the emergency room. Now, I don't tell you that story to discourage you from sitting next to me at prayer.
Right.
Not to turn something or not taking blame for it. But rather, that this is somewhat emblematic and representative, I should say, of what a career for a uniformed medical officer is like. And whether we chose to do this as a part of our training or not, we become leaders at MSF that are across the province. And I can go into many, many more that have been a part and punctual in my career. And for that reason, on the first day of the first class, in the first hour of medical school in E. Pelham's School of Medicine, the first class given to our medical students is on leadership. 170 medical students, many of whom did not come thinking that they were going to be leaders, are told about the basics of leadership. And what we explain to them is they're getting this because the uniformed members, whether they're in the Army, Navy, Air Force, Navy, the Marine Corps, Navy, physician, or the public health service, they will, by necessity, become leaders in events like this. And they need to understand the principles that you just heard about. So this is a very important message. I'm really privileged to be a part of this. I want to point out one of our other senior faculty, Neil Broomer, who's in the back of the room, will be here all day. I look forward to a very productive session today and wish you the very best. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Next up is Dr. Cullen, the Dean of the School of Medicine.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to America's Medical School and to the Uniformed Services University, the Leadership Academy for Military Health in the United States and the U.S. Public Health Service. I picked both of those terms very intentionally. We like to call this America's Medical School because it's a lot easier to remember than our 17-word official name. Second, because it really defines who we are. We are unique among American medical schools in that we are operated, owned, and managed by the United States government for the benefit of the United States people. Our medical students come from across the country, from all walks of life, from all backgrounds, ethnicities, regions, occupations, family histories, and come here to learn and work with each other. 35 to 40% of our students are prior service, academy grads, ROTC, former tank drivers, fighter pilots, special forces medics, and the like. And they sit next to former Peace Corps volunteer, college whiz kid, a PhD in molecular biology, who is now in that same classroom. It's an extraordinary combination. None of them are charged tuition. None of them pay a dime in fees. They are all paid the salary of a junior officer to become a doctor. And in return, they commit a minimum after residency of 7 years of national service in the Medical Corps of the Army, Navy, Air Force, or Public Health Service. It is one of the best win-win propositions in American education today. And our alumni, now over 5,500, have demonstrated that over nearly 45 years of service to this country in remarkable places around the world, as well as at home. And you just heard some examples from General Schoonmaker. The university takes that to an even larger scale because we have a graduate school of nursing that's training advanced practitioners in family nursing, critical care, mental health nurse practitioners, geriatric nurse practitioners, who are increasingly the backbone of military nursing and direct practice. And they are also leaders. We have a postgraduate dental college with campuses around the country. Our students also rotate around the country in the medical school in our national campus. And very recently, we now, with the permission of Congress, will be granting undergraduate degrees so that enlisted providers, medics, corpsmen, operating room techs, nuclear medicine techs, and the like, will be able to get an associate or a bachelor's degree. Not only so they'll be able to do remarkable things for our military, but have a career pathway whenever they take off the uniform and return to civilian life. So this is the coolest university in the country, and one that I feel very privileged to be a part of. Being the dean does have perks, particularly here. They actually call you sir, which I almost never heard at Emory University or other places I work. I get to work with some of the most amazing students in America, but most significantly for me is when President Thomas is not in town, and regrettably he's not in town today, I get to introduce the speakers, the really cool ones. And so it was with great pleasure that I introduced our keynote speaker this morning, Admiral retired Thad Allen. And Admiral Allen and I crossed paths briefly in a former organization, and so I got to know him several years ago, and I'm particularly appreciative and delighted that he's here with us today. Admiral Allen retired from the Coast Guard in 2010 as its 23rd Commandant. He currently serves as a senior executive advisor at Booz Allen Hamilton, where he supports government and commercial clients in a range of issues, including cybersecurity, energy and the environment, emergency response, and crisis leadership. He's a 1971 graduate of the Coast Guard Academy, another leadership academy. And he holds master's degrees from George Washington University and the MIT Sloan School of Management. I think Admiral Allen is best known to the American people for a couple of defining events in his career and in the history of our nation. He led the United States response to Hurricanes Katrina and Rita, which you remember were horrific back-to-back hurricanes that smashed New Orleans and the Gulf Coast. 5 years later, he was called back to coordinate the federal response to the Deepwater Horizon oil spill, probably the greatest environmental catastrophe, and one that unfolded over weeks while the entire world watched. So in both cases, he not only had to manage extreme critical events, but not for a night or a morning or a mass casualty that was over in 6 hours, but events that kept going and going and going and had a very uncertain outcome. And many of us were either involved in that or watched that on television as these incidents unfolded. But he also directed U.S. Coast Guard operations in the wake of the September 11, 2001 attack and the 2010 Haitian earthquake. Admiral Allen is a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, fellow in the National Academy of Public Administration. He continues to serve on several federal advisory committees, and finally holds the James Tyler Chair at the Admiral James N. Joy Institute for Leadership at the Coast Guard Academy. I am very excited that he's here today. It means a lot to all of us at the university. Admiral, thank you very much for being here.
I was on a trade delegation visit to New Zealand after I retired and was in Christchurch when that earthquake happened. So stay away from both of us. I do a lot of talking on this subject, but I have to tell you that the main reason why I'm qualified to step up here to speak to you this morning was I was involved in these events, the hurricane and the earthquake, and I wasn't fired. This is a singular accomplishment of worship. So what I thought I'd do this morning is talk a little bit about the world we live in. And some of that's been alluded to already in the introductory remarks. Highlight some of the things that happened and the responses that I've been involved in. And I'm happy to do some Q&A. I don't know how the format's set up here, and we can have a discussion if you like. So let me talk about the world we live in. A couple of years ago, I had an opportunity to spend some time with Tom Friedman, who writes op-eds for the New York Times, won a couple of Pulitzer Prizes. He wrote a book called The Lessons in Knowledge. Tree, something you may have read his work lately, and it's Thank You for Being Late. In the process of writing that book, we were talking about trends in the world that are problematic. And he's very pithy. And in his book, he boils it down to what he calls the 3 M's. So I'd go through those real quick because it kind of paints a picture of the complexity of the world we live in, which drives demands for leadership and how we deal with our people. The first one is Moore's Law. That's a shorthand for the rapid advance of technology. Every generation on Earth can always say they're the most technologically advanced in the history of the universe. But what's happening to us that's so different is the rapid acceleration of the pace of change. And what it's doing is it's driving change that's faster than governing structures can react to it. And whether you're trying to acquire technology in the government and deploy it, and just to deploy it for mission stuff, it's hard. It always has been hard with the Code of Federal Regulations and the Federal Acquisition Regulations. But it's also hard to provide oversight and do the things the American public expects of you when you can't absorb that technology and understand it. So I don't know how many people here have an iPhone, but in your iPhone you'll find a GPS chip for geolocation, but you would also find a Russian GLONASS chip, because they work better at high latitudes. Now you're not supposed to have a GPS receiver in this country unless it's been licensed or permitted by the FCC. Apple doesn't wait. The markets don't wait. They move. Anywhere from cybersecurity to cryptocurrencies, the rapid pace of change is starting to challenge governing structures, legal structures, traditional boundaries. And what really becomes a problem is when technological change happens so fast, it starts to challenge our doctrine and our policies, so we can't be reactive. I'll talk a little bit more about that as we move forward. The other thing about technology is the ubiquity of information, social media, and the ability to know things or not understand what's going on, whether you're actually getting the truth or not. All that is related to the rapid advance of technology. The second thing is Mother Nature. Shortly after what we're observing and what's going on with our climate. And I don't care where you stand on global warming. Something's happened there. I remember sitting in a hearing when I was commandant, and a senator looked over the top of his glasses at me and said, Admiral Allen, what is your opinion on global warming? Like I was going to touch that in a hearing. And I looked at him and I said, well, sir, I'm kind of agnostic to the science, but there's water that didn't used to be, and I'm responsible. Okay, so John Holder, the Science and Technology Advisor in the last administration, said there are three ways to deal with climate change: suffer, adapt, or manage. And I would add that I consider the rapid expanse of social media, the rapid expanse of the ubiquity of information, which is global now, I consider that to be the sociological equivalent of climate change. I would tell you we have three choices: suffer, adapt, or manage. An increased intersection with the natural environment and the built environment, We have that Diego room, I'm sure we're going to talk later, but he and I just worked after the Ebola event. But my understanding, and I'm not a qualified medical person, so I'm willing to be corrected. But my understanding is the Ebola virus was restricted to fruit bats in Central Africa until we opened up resources, lines of communication, and so forth. So we don't know what the interaction always is between the natural and the built environment and the implications of that. As another dimension of complexity. The third area that Tom Friedman will talk about is markets, but I like to talk about globalization. I don't mean globalization of the economy. We're always going to have labor driven to markets where the cost is lowest. I'm talking about the globalization of everything, including information. And there's a big G and a little g. It is a really positive aspect, the ubiquity of information, in that we have the ability to know more about everybody, more about the world, and sometimes more about ourselves. But we're also seeing this as well established in the current political environment. We see things we haven't seen before, we don't understand them. We have a tendency to withdraw, and it's actually in some cases creating divisions and factions where people don't understand what's happening and they get scared. So how we try to manage this milieu that's going on in our world right now is pretty significant. So the upshot of Moore's Law, Mother Nature, and Marcus is we're dealing in a world that's much more complex than it has been in the past. And I'd like to draw a distinction between something that's being complicated and something that's complex. In my view, something that's complex starts to defeat policy, doctrine, and the normal way of operating, where things don't work like they're supposed to. It requires leaders to assess whether or not they've got the problem right, whether or not they've got the solution right. Again, getting back to the Ebola event, we had folks that were not honoring contracts. The normal training tactics and procedures were not followed because either fear, there were issues about whether or not there was going to be liability, things just started breaking down. We need to understand when that happens. Sometimes we need to reassess what's going on and try to figure out whether we have the right assumptions about what the problem is. I'll talk about that a little bit later on. But one of the features of complexity is that there's no one single entity or person that can solve the problem. And you're probably all aware of that, but let me just make it really clear. There's no complex situation in the world today that can be solved by a single agency, entity, private sector person, individual, or not-for-profit. That's because the outcomes that are expected by the American public or to solve the problems have to be co-produced. So the two features I'd like to focus on today are the complexity of the world we live in. It's volatile, it's uncertain, there's ambiguity, as was stated before. And any solution that's going to meet the standards of the American public that they're being protected is going to have to be co-produced. Those two things require, in my view, rethinking what leadership is, how we need to build leaders, and how leaders need to act in situations. And the opening comments were dead on in talking about the subject of leadership in the crisis. Because when you lose the touchstone of a legal framework or a doctrine you've depended on for years, or training tactics and procedures, and the rebuttal presumption is they've been tested and they work, when that starts to break down, leaders still need to act under conditions of uncertainty and compressed time frames, the high level of ambiguity. So what I'd like to do is go through a couple of events that I've been involved in my life that also have to do with emotional well-being. The question I get asked most about the things I was involved in, how did I take care of me? And it's a pretty good question. So let me go through a couple of anecdotes here, and then we'll have a discussion about where I think we need to drive leadership moving forward. Let's start with the hurricane. Hurricane Katrina came ashore on the 29th of August, 2005. At the time, I was the chief of staff at the Coast Guard, three-star position. A week later, I was called by Secretary Chertoff and asked to go down and assist Mike Brown, who had been deployed to head of FEMA, and basically see what I could do about all the problems we're in New Orleans. And you're all familiar with it. It appears like for days on end, nothing was being done. We had a meltdown at the Superdome and the Convention Center. It appeared that despite emergency declarations and all kinds of help and support flowing into New Orleans, nothing seemed to be happening. We had CNN correspondents standing on the street corner with a set of remains there. 24 hours later, they're there and the remains are still there. American public was aghast and didn't appear the government was capable of working. I flew into Baton Rouge on the 9th of the 5th of September, Labor Day, 1 week after the storm came ashore. And after a very short and unproductive discussion with Mike Brown, I basically said I was going to head to New Orleans and I would report back on what was going on. It was the last conversation I had with him. Once I got to New Orleans and saw what was going on, I dealt directly with Secretary Chertoff, the president. Sometimes you just got to cut through the levels and talk to the people and do something about it. When I landed in New Orleans, I had an aha moment. It was related to what I just talked about. I realized we got the problem wrong. Now let me go back and just make one thing clear because I want to talk about the law school in a minute. In our country, under the Constitution, all powers not granted to the federal government are reserved to the states. A disaster response is one of those. Now, the federal government can help pursuant to a disaster declaration, but that's acting like a large insurance company providing any kind of support or resources, and the department provides support to civil authorities. The basic legal authority to direct the response lies with local leaders, in this case the mayor and the governor. In the week leading up to my employment to New Orleans, there was a lot of talk in the Pentagon about whether or not they should invoke martial law or wait posse comitatus and basically militarize what was going on down there. Legally, they had no premise to do it because they had a standing mayor and a governor. Usually that happens when you have a capitation of leadership. So now you've lost two leaders. You lost continuity of leadership. But what really happened was, the storm was gone in 24 hours. New Orleans lost continuity of government. They lost the elements of civil society, anywhere from the courts to the jails, emergency response, police service, and everything else. They could not take the resources that were being deployed and apply them back to any kind of mission effect. They had no command and control capability. And so nobody could figure out why things weren't working for them. My challenge was to figure out how to do that because it was clear that unless we reestablish the elements of civil society and the capabilities of the city, we were going to fail, and we had failed for a week. So what I did was I sat down with Lieutenant General Russ Honore, who led Joint Task Force Katrina. You might have met Russ Honore? May not be right, but he's never in doubt.
Absolutely.
And they used to call him the John Wayne dude down there. And Russ and I don't agree on a lot of things, but one thing Russ brought in was he removed all ambiguity about what the mission was, that was to take care of people, and he reinforced in the minds of the public that people were there to help, they cared, and some folks were going to be done. So my job, representing the president, was to kind of put all the stuff together and make it work. So what we ended up doing was dividing New Orleans into sectors. We assigned one of Russ Honore's components to each one of the sectors. So for instance, the 82nd Airborne had the Central Business District. The lower 9th Ward in St. Bernard Parish had been hit with a 25-foot storm surge. Then the levee collapsed and a flood of the lower 9th Ward, and then there was a million-gallon oil tank that burst from oil came off its foundation and slimed everything. That was so bad we gave that to the Marines. And what we did was, we did what we called a hasty sweep. We provided high water vehicles, rubber boats, administrative support, logistics, communications, and so forth. 20 or 30 person teams headed by two local police officers or Louisiana state police officers using their legal authority of local government. And we touched their infrastructure. And you probably saw the circle of the X and the icons that indicated when they were there and what they had found. As we unlarded the city, we made secondary and tertiary sweeps. So by the time, I'd say 9 to 10 days later, we had swept the city three times. Because we needed to find out whether we had total coverage on who needed to be saved. We had to start the very difficult, really difficult task that remains recovery and remains identification. There was no state medical examiner in the state of Louisiana. All the coroners are elected by popular vote at the parish level. Other than that, that wasn't difficult. We actually found a grade school wasn't being used in St. Gabriel, Louisiana, south of Baton Rouge. There was a warehouse across the street, and there was an open field next to the school. And in 4 days, we set up a base camp in the school, brought in the Forest Service to set up a food, clothing, shelter, and all that stuff under an ICS command. We took all the refrigerated trucks that had been sitting behind the convention center in New Orleans where we've been putting the remains. We didn't tell the public that because that would have been a little unsettling. And we moved those trucks to the open area by the grade school, and inside the warehouse, we basically put in positive air containment tent instead of all the procedures we need to actually do the having the remains. It was extraordinary. Something like you had never seen, not generally well known in response. We stabilized the operation response in about 72 hours. Because we assigned areas of responsibility, we're going to duty about what the task was, we just had to get it all done then. That pretty much stabilized. I get asked a lot, get in Norway, what would you like to do in Katrina? And I said, I'd like to be there for 29 miles. Because for 1 week, we labored under solving the wrong problem. Once we got our arms around it, it was okay. Now, we had other problems with FEMA trailers, and people we put in the hotels were homeless, when we tried to take care of it. So, let me give you a couple of examples of leadership that I ran into and some of the stuff associated with well-being, and I'll talk about the Rust Belt. On the 9th of September, I was told to come to Battery by Secretary Chertoff. And I went up there and said, couldn't have shut the door. We had taken over a big dealer's warehouse in Central Baton Rouge, and that's where we had the joint field office for response. There were 5,000 people in this old dealer's store. Secretary Chertoff said, we're going to have a news conference in 30 minutes, and we're going to leave Mike Brown the entire response for the whole coast. In case you want to know how detailed my casting was, that was it. Called Mike Brown and told him what was going to happen. Mike Brown got up and said, they go out there and they attack me, I'm probably turn the fire, I'm going to go out there and be bullied or belittled. And Mike Chertoff said, you can keep your goddamn mouth shut, I'll go talk. I'm looking for a table tonight. But already into Google look at it, you'll see him sit there on the back, just like, when's this going to be over? Press conference ended, Chertoff left, Mike Brown stormed out, resigned a week later as a FEMA director. There were 5,000 people. On my way in, I stopped and talked to a FEMA employee. And I asked her how she was doing it. She told me this is the most rewarding thing she'd ever done in her life. That she was just completely caught up in what she was doing to help people. Then she said, but you know, I go back to my hotel room at night and I can't turn on the television. All I see is my agency and my leader vilified. And she had kind of a hangdog look that just kind of broke my heart. So after everybody stormed out, I told my military aide was with me. By the way, her name was Katrina. I said, I want an all hands meeting. She goes, there's too many people in this building, we can't get them all in one place. To get as many people somewhere, I want to talk to them. So about 30 minutes later, I went down to the bottom floor of this warehouse. And I got up on a desk with a loud here where there were about 2,000 people. I said, here's what I got to do. I got to go back to New Orleans. I got to make sure all that works. I looked out at that sea of faces, and that looked like that lady I talked to. So I told them, well, I said, I'm giving you an order. I have no legal authority to do by anymore. There's no saying in the military diplomacy, you don't have sovereignty unless you exert it. You can cry. I told them all to treat everybody they come in contact with who's impacted by the storm as if they were a member of their own family. Their mother, the father, brother, sister. I said, if you do that, two things are going to happen. First of all, if you make a mistake, you're going to err on the side of doing too much, but just point of response, I'm okay with that. We'll figure it out later. Second, if somebody's got a problem with what you're doing, their problem will be because I told them. It was my decision, it's my work. At that point, people started opening and weeping in the room. There was a collective sigh of change of air and pressure. Nobody ever told these folks in very simple terms what the true mission was. Nobody ever talked about the values associated with the mission. They could all buy into to be the basis for trust between everybody. And nobody ever told anybody that they're back. Because the most important thing when you're doing one of these events is unity of effort. It's getting everybody to buy in, have trust, and know you're all trying to work towards the same end, because you're going to be trying to run an operation where you have no legal authority to direct. And since we're at the Uniform Services School here, let me just foot stomp that a little bit. In the military, we have unity of command. So the first thing you learn when you come into the military, whether it's boot camp, academy, or anyplace else, you learn your chain of command clear to the president. If you're a private, it's your sergeant, platoon leader, right on up, you can name the whole thing, it's unambiguous. It's also locked into law. If you give somebody a hard time or disobey an order, there are actually legal consequences associated with that. When you move outside Title 10 operations under DOD, or Title 32 of the National Guard, the best you're ever going to achieve is unity of effort. But unity of effort should be your goal. And unity of effort requires you to move beyond legal authorities and create a cause for action that people are willing to buy into. My biggest challenge in anything I've done is just that, to create unity of effort. And I'm going to talk to you about the two things I think are most critical in a minute to building that. But let me talk briefly about the Wells Pole. Wells Pole is completely different. 45 miles offshore, state waters into three, clear federal preemption. Federal laws passed after the Exxon Valdez, the Clean Water Act, made it perfectly clear federal government was in charge. So I had a different problem with the Wells Pole. I had two problems. One, the local parish presidents in Louisiana thought it was a disaster. There should be a declaration. They should get the resources. They were clean enough oil. They neither had the scope, scale, or competency to do it, but thought they did. And didn't want to be have terms dictated to them, especially further south you got on the river, Blackman's Parish. On the other side, I had a president and a cabinet that were skeptical of the doctrine. Whenever I talk about complexity, it starts defeating doctrine. We had set up a doctrine after the Exxon Valdez where you could legally designate a responsible party in an incident, and they were liable for all the cleanup costs, including the cost of the federal government. So the doctrine called for BP to manage the response under the supervision of the federal government, but I was suffering a political and social nullification of the response time, like jury nullification. Everybody, clear to the president, didn't believe that the entity was responsible for the event to be consequential in solving the problem. BP didn't have to be told it was an existential threat to the firm. They almost went under as a firm. They waived limits liability, doing everything they could to convince everybody they wanted to solve the problem. One morning, President Obama went on the Today Show and told Matt Lauer he was going to kick BP's ass. I called Carol Brown at the White House and said, not helpful. This is on top of a moratorium on oil and gas drilling, which alienated all the stakeholders we had alienated already because we closed out all the fishing grounds. None of that helped me capital. So what tends to happen, one of these things, you've got somebody to be mad at, you start conflating operations and policy, and you do that, you fail at both. You don't make policy when you're trying to solve an operational problem. Okay? Ned and I have talked about this before. We have this thing moving again about unaccompanied children at the border right now. It's starting to ramp back up. A couple years ago when that happened, we had Border Patrol chiefs with 300 kids in a gym somewhere in Laredo that have to be moved somewhere and be taken care of. And we're going to have a conversation about immigration reform. That's conflating policy and operation. If you do that, you don't do anything right. And that's one of the problems I had during the Wells Pole. So having clear lines of authority, we don't have honest conversations about that, is important. I got another story, but I'm gonna go to a couple points I want to make when we go to Q&A. If you want to have any more detail, I can help you out on that. Both of these incidents required me to have personal contact with the president, fly with him in helicopters, brief him on Air Force One, hold press conferences. So in addition to everything else that was safe stated here, sooner or later to move up in positions of leadership, you have to be able to talk frank, openly, and honestly with the press. Keep your cool, not let them make you, and create the kind of transparency and trust in the American public you have to establish to be successful in the event. So let me go through a couple of things. So after Mike Brown left, I was sitting in the office in Baton Rouge, and they came in and they said, the local news affiliates where they had like 200,000 people in San Antonio want to talk to you remote at their local newscast, the national news. So they put me on where I had 5-minute clips on 10 stations starting at Corpus Christi all the way to Atlanta. So I'm talking to the NBC News affiliate in San Antonio, and I heard a different voice come on, and I'm in a closet with the earpiece, just looking at a camera. And I said, who am I speaking to? I said, it's Attorney General of the State of Texas. Okay? She said, will you please tell us why FEMA is refusing to release names of registered sex offenders who were in New Orleans and maybe in our shelters. Hadn't heard that one before. So I'll try not to do this on camera. And I basically said, I have not heard that was an issue. I will look into it. I'll either issue a statement when I have the answer, or I'll give it to you tomorrow on my daily briefing. Okay? I didn't know the answer. I didn't know it was a problem. But I was honest about it. What did I get out of that? I got 24 hours. So I go back and I bring my lawyer in, the female lawyer was attacked. I said, go find out what's going on here. This can't be true. Comes back 30 minutes later, he says, can't tell. What? You signed up with FEMA benefits, the Privacy Act applies, and you know, you can't reveal that information. I said, we're on the wrong side of this issue. I said, I want to talk to somebody else. I talked to the general counsel of FEMA. He told me the same thing. I called the deputy secretary of Homeland Security. I said, we got to be on the right side of this event. I said, if that's the answer, then maybe you don't need me down here. So every once in a while, you may want to play that card, by the way. Don't take one of these jobs unless you're prepared to be fired. So finally, he had Phil Perry call me, who was the general counsel of Homeland Security, who was a son-in-law of Dick Cheney. So he's a little riot of trouble, huh? He gave me the answer. He said, the local police chief asked the Department of Justice, they have to give me the answer. Said, really? Yeah. We did it, it worked. So 2 weeks later, these two guys walked over from the Center for Disease Control. And they said, we've been tracking these cases of tuberculosis in and around New Orleans. We'd like to know where they're at and what we can do about it. I said, I'd like to know that too. Called a lawyer, and guess what he said? Can't tell. So if you were a leader, what would you do? I said, you're fired. He said, I work for FEMA, you can't fire me. Well, that's right. Get out of my office. Well, go back to Washington. The ultimate getting away from GSA was wonderful. Go figure. But sometimes you just got to say, you know, we're not going to do that. We're just not going to do that. Oil spill. I'm being interviewed live in the Situation Room with Wolf Blitzer. And he goes, Admiral Allen, I want to play this clip with Anderson Cooper last night. I went, oh, God. I had a standing joke that it's impossible to insult me because I've been interviewed by Anderson Cooper. So they play Anderson Cooper talking to the parish president of Plaquemines Parish in Lower Mississippi. And he's basically called the president an idiot. President idiot for hiring me, I'm an idiot, he should actually be fired. It ends with, well, do you have a comment? keep it cool, right? I said, Wolf, I appreciate your feedback on my performance when I work for the President of the United States. Do you have another question? And he did. Okay. So a quick video my grandfather used to tell me applies to these situations. Don't ever wrestle with a pig. Y'all heard that? You get money, the pig likes it. Okay. What does all this mean? Two things. I've taken leaders, first of all, I subscribe to almost every leadership model that's ever been in a book and got somebody on the bestseller list. It's all good. But none of them are the holy grail, none of them are the silver bullet. All right, if models were perfect, crime would have stopped with each particular commandments, and that obviously didn't happen. Okay? The two things I think make great leaders, two things. One of them, lifelong learners. Okay, how rapidly can you absorb information? And in the state of accelerated technology, how can you do high velocity learning? When the O-ring blew on the 20th of April, 2010, by the way, that's my wife's birthday, so I don't forget it. I did not know what a blowout preventer was. 10 days later, I was in the White House press room with a pointer explaining it on live television to the American public. Okay? Those synapses are not firing. You're not staying up to speed on what's going on. Not only are you being overtaken by technology, you can't absorb stuff as rapidly as you need to when you're under stress. Lifelong learning, insatiable curiosity, continue to read, treat your life as the development of a craft, and you're the center of that, and how you want to evolve your craft over a lifetime. The second one is emotional intelligence. And that's the ability to understand you, what makes you mad, allows you to have empathy for other people. It allows you keep your cool. I found out a long time ago, I was pretty hot-headed junior officer. I got a lot of trouble. I was kind of a board game coast team in accident lab. You got to know when to just calm yourself down and not let stuff get space in your head. Okay? I came across an interesting term working for a former RAND colleague, Anita Chandra, who Art knows. You guys already know about this so-called allostatic load. I'm not a doctor. I'm not going to pretend to be one. I didn't say Holiday Express last night. But this is, as I understand it, it's a physiological impact of repeated stressors. And you put in a psychological fight or flight type syndrome, and you got all your hormones rushing in the adrenal gland and everything else. And repeated stresses like that ultimately start to produce physiological outcomes. So while I'm not a doctor and I've read about it and I know about it, I think that can also happen in communities. Repeated events that happen. So what do you do for your wellness and how do you keep that from happening to you? Well, first of all, you gotta learn to settle down, be very selective about what kind of space in your head. You gotta be a careful lessor. You gotta create the personal discipline to restrain it and constrain it out. So you keep focused on what it is you gotta do. The other thing regarding emotional intelligence is the ability to seek other opinions. This goes beyond empathy and insight to making good decisions. There's a lot of talk over the last few decades about diversity. I always sought cognitive diversity in my staff around me. Different viewpoints, to use a military nautical metaphor. You have lines of positions across, that's where your position is fixed at. The more lines across in that dot, the higher fidelity your fix is, in this case, a solution to a problem. The more varying viewpoints you can bring to bear on a problem, the more robust and high fidelity your solution is going to be. And you know what? If you focus on that and you actually seek it out, you get the other diversity naturally. And in fact, in my view, that's the right way to do it. Based on the value that the people bring to the problem, and you're anxious to hear what their point of view is because it's different than yours. So, to counterbalance the complexity and the need to co-produce, is to have leaders that are lifelong learners and engage in emotional intelligence. And you can pick a leadership model, and there's a lot of them out there. But to make those effectively work, you've got to build that basic level of trust. People have to understand that you're looking out for their welfare as well. There's sometimes you can't help. I've met people at these events that are completely unconsolable about what happened. There are people that once they see three or four wild birds are unconsolable for the rest of the event about what happened. And that's okay, you have to respect their feelings. You have to respect their emotions. But at some point you say, we're gonna use somebody to talk to, we're gonna help you on that, but we've got to go fix the problem. You gotta be able to handle both of those at once, but with skill and understanding so the people understand where you're coming from. I did a panel a while back with Keith Alexander, former NSA director, and looking at some of the threats we face today, including cybersecurity, and what it means to actually have somebody take down our financial institutions. In his mind, in my mind, what is a national security issue and what's a law enforcement issue becoming pretty well blurred out there. And we were having a discussion about the actual wording of the Constitution, about what constitutes the general welfare, what does it mean to provide for the common defense in this complex world we live in. Those are the kind of challenges that leaders are going to have to face in dealing with a complex world. So, I can talk for a long, long time, but why don't we go to some Q&A? We're pretty much on time, of course. Happy to respond to questions or have a dialogue here. But thanks for having me.
Any questions to the group?
Any questions?
Obviously, it's way in the back up there.
Sure.
Go ahead and ask another.
Shout out.
Yes. First, I served under you in Baton Rouge and New Orleans, and I will convey to those who haven't had the experience of one of your motivating talks that they are important vehicles, not only for making people feel better, but for focusing on what the priorities are, because there's so often tiny tasks in the larger mission that people get ingrained in, and they don't see the big picture. So I want to share with you that even now, 13 years after, those talks had a profound effect. Now, my question is that you mentioned attorneys and so forth who are attempting to manage risk, but there are very many kinds of risks in any given situation. And could you comment on conveying to others the assessment of risks, how you do
sure.
assess risks and how you convey those.
Sure. For those who may not have heard, the issue is that when we get a lot of lawyers involved and provide us legal advice, and you're dealing with risky situations, how do you really manage risk? Well, first let me say something, and I have a lot of good friends and relatives that are lawyers. Okay? But the term is advice, not direction. Okay? The only legal direction you gotta follow comes from a judge or a law enforcement officer. Lawyers provide counsel. And it's very good counsel, and you need to listen to it. But it is advice. And sometimes you have to go at risk and understand that somebody's gonna take the consequences of a decision that may have to do it. Managing risk has everything to do with the time frame you're operating in. Because everybody has to make decisions. The question is under compressed time, conditions of uncertainty, they can get information. The more time you got, the more you can fill those things in, develop more robust solutions and options, consult with your staff and make a good decision. It might be much harder cases are when you don't have time. You got a few options and you have to make a decision. So let me focus on that. But I think it's really important to individuals. I've spent a lot of talking over the years about folks who got caught up in situations. This is anything from the commanding officers of ships that are running around, to folks that have had suicides on their units, those types of things. When you have to make a decision, here's my standard. If you explain after the fact how you contemporaneously dealt with what was going on so that a reasonable person would say, I get that, you can have a low probability, high consequence outcome. That can always happen. But if you can say something like, I literally had 5 minutes to make a decision. There are only 3 viable alternatives that could work. One of these was very, very bad. I had to choose between these two. Given the information I had and people I consulted with, I picked this. Then it goes south. Right? So if very much people in the room, they go, I understand all of that. If everybody understands that's what you did and you can articulate it, then they're dealing with the quality of the information you had, the time you had to make it, and the inputs you had. You know what they're not talking about? Your behavior. Your behavior. You didn't win it. You weren't acting emotionally. You created a framework that you could articulate after the fact as a basis for your decision, such that a reading person would say, yeah, and it went south. That is a discussion you can have. The other one is a discussion about your character, your behavior, and how you demonstrated by your actions how not to do something. Does that make sense?
Sir, I just wanted to know what gave you the idea of applying three-dimensional battle management to the oil spill?
Yeah.
And if you could talk about it?
Sure. Three-dimensional battle management. Actually, I've been asked if there's anything in the oil spill I would do over again. I said yes. I would have taken the airspace on the first day. On the first day. We got subsea looking for oil in the water column. I knew because of the Haiti response. The only way we were going to get, and this was a situation with the president, the port in Port-au-Prince collapsed. There was a runway with one airstrip, marginally usable, and then a 10-hour convoy for the Dominican Republic. Those only ways in until they built the port. About 2 days into the event, then Secretary Clinton went down and negotiated with the president of Haiti to allow the U.S. Air Force to take over the airspace. Then I got together with Craig Fugate and Razi Shah, USAID, and we put a team together to start prioritizing, triaging the material, equipment, and people that would be going down there. In the first 24 hours after the earthquake, there were 12 landings there. At the height of the operation, 3 weeks later, there were 160. Just lined up, coming in like it was National Airport. That could not have happened without controlling the airspace. On the second week of June, I was with President Obama in Pensacola, Florida, flying back in Air Force One, and I realized I had to make some changes because the problems I talked about was too complex, it wasn't scaling right. We weren't focusing on how to do this correctly because we were going to war with how we fought a tanker accident with the Exxon Valdez. And I'm sitting in front of the airplane because the president went somewhere, all of a sudden somebody nudges me, look down, and President Obama is like this far from my nose. Performance counseling. So he leans over and goes, Dad, you have all the resources. I said, sir, it's not a resource issue between the government and BP. we have all the resources we need. I got a problem with supply chain. There's not enough room in the world to satisfy 5 Republican governors right now. But you need to let me manage that. If I don't do it right, then I get fired. That's my problem. So you sure you got everything you need? I said, well, sir, I'd like to take over the airspace. I said, we should have ordered this after Port of Prince, and I should have thought of it sooner. We had 8 near mid-airs in 6 weeks. Flying logistics after the ribs, surveillance, all that kind of stuff. And I said, on a good morning, I'm going to call Mike Mullen, Nordy Schwartz at Air Force, and Gene Renoir at Northcom. And 7 days later, we took over the airspace down at Tyndall Air Force Base, right where we also do the defense of North America. Should have done it the first day.
You touched on this with your opening remarks at Katrina in that warehouse, but talk about the importance in a leader of integrity.
Well, it's hard to look at the American people every day, and in both cases, I gave a press conference once a day for like 3 months. You can't be honest and transparent with the American public unless you're honest and transparent with yourself and everything you do is related to integrity, because at least I know right now I'm approaching 70 and I can't remember what I said. So it's hard to keep track of lies, you know, if you don't try. But the biggest thing is you don't know, say you don't know, but say it artfully. I wonder whether that was an issue. I'll look here and I'll be back in so many hours with a written statement, but I'm available. If you lose that trust with the American people, you lose everything. And whether you believe it or not, you demonstrate every day by your behavior and how you act, who you are, even if you're not talking, the verbals are there. How you hold yourself, how you deal with other people, and everything else. This gets back to emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence has to be grounded in your own personal ethos and your ethics. Otherwise, it's not going to work. There are sometimes, in both cases, I threatened to walk if something wasn't changed. I was asked to insert a line in a press statement to criticize Governor Tyndall of Louisiana for not being more supportive of what the administration was trying to do. And I said, that's not the case. Everybody wants this thing to go away. And so one of the quotes went out, so the president wants you to say it. Oh, let's go talk to him. He always said if I had a problem, I'd see him. That was telling you I didn't want to meet him. I started in for the old. Well, the president didn't say it, but we know he's not being cooperative. We think he ought to do it. I said, all right, here's the deal. You do this again, I'm resigning and I'm naming you. I'm retiring my pension this year. I don't need this. And I never heard from him again. But every once in a while, there's another issue. If you survive like 2 or 3 weeks in one of these jobs, it makes it harder to fire you. But there's an old saying, if you owe the bank $10, it's your problem. If you owe the bank $1 million, it's the bank's problem. That's really you have this equity and credibility built up every day, because you don't know when you're going to have to draw on it, but when you're really needed.
Thank you. You mentioned that one of the questions you get frequently asked is how do you take care of yourself? If you could talk a little bit more about the details of that and what personally some of the greatest stressors were.
Sure. Well, actually, it gets back to emotional intelligence. You have to talk yourself down. A lot of times you get all excited like this, there's no way to talk to. You know, I have a lot of people I can talk to, and you should do that. This is not the traditional definition in England, but I call it peerage. People around you know what your life's like, you know, you have a similar, it's almost like peer mentoring or something like that. And you need to reach out to those folks to have normalizing relationships and conversations that continue through these things. You gotta calm yourself down, you gotta actually take some time out in the day for reflection. Some quiet time, even if it's 30 minutes, you gotta do that. Now the things that de-stress me is music. I like all kinds of music. I can, you know, just give me a room for an hour, and you put some headphones on, and I can come back in about an hour, and the world's pretty much right. Another one is being careful about the space in your head. For the time that you're doing one of these things, get rid of everything. When there were triage with the folks at Landstuhl, right? You weren't thinking about anything else at that point, right? You just think about the task. And if you can do that, get the other stuff out of your brain, you can deal with it later. It's like you wake up in the middle of the night. Unless you can fix it then, you have to write a note or send an email. You got to tell yourself to go back to sleep. But I learned to do that about 20 years ago. Also, if I was in an aircraft for more than 20 minutes, I went to sleep. I got all kinds of pictures, really funny pictures of me hanging in a 5-point harness. but I was vindicated. We're flying back from Venice on Marine One with the president during the oil spill. We get in the president, Brock, look around, everybody said, how long's the flight? They said, 40 minutes, Jim Cramer said, I'm going to sleep. And he did. That's my man. it's a combination of everything. But reflection, learn how to de-stress yourself. And then one other thing, I'm going to call once a week during the oil spill. Once a week, I'm sorry, I had no legal responsibility or any authority or anything involving me. Just said, are you getting enough sleep? All right, you doing okay? How's your family? Just checking in. Mike Mullen, chairman of the joint staff, his personal family. He had no reason to do it. And then one day he showed up in New Orleans, surprised everybody, walked around and gave out 400 points. Just to tell him he was American out there, he was in a position where he could say thank you to him. He saved me a MasterCard commercial. Priceless.
As a follow-up to that, how do you instill that into your direct subordinates? And then even more complicatedly, how do you reach those way down the chain?
Yeah, you do it in front of them. You leave at 5. Then they'll leave maybe at 5:30 or 6. You stay at 7, they're alone at 8 or 9. Show them by your own behavior what you value. The thing we should value most is our time. How we spend our time is one of the hugest nonverbal signals we send to anybody. Okay? And people are way down the line. I made a lot of unit business. And I call it Allen's inverted cone model. I talk about models earlier, it's a model. Think of two cones that are inverted. They're touching right at the point. And you drive them down to where they're both at the base, where there's one point and a big circle and both touching. So when I went out to a unit, there's a seaman in the station towing a part of me. I needed to understand there was at least part of his world of work where the unit was still abortion was trying to do for him. Okay. I need to understand where I was at, how I honored and thought what he did was important enough. There must be enough overlap. Because you don't expect him to answer budget questions. But he should expect me to demonstrate that I have knowledge, empathy, and some insight in what he does every day, even if he's a repeat too. And that's what I try to use my crowd.
Any other questions?
Okay, thank you, folks.
Thank you very much.
Admiral Allen, two quick presentations. First, I don't have 400 coins, but I have one.
Right.
From America's Medical School, so thank you very much. And second, we want to present you with this book. It's Out of the Crucible. It tells the story of how the U.S. military transformed combat casualty care in Iraq and Afghanistan. In every page are stories, illustrations, episodes where military medical officers, alumni of the school, their colleagues, nurses, enlisted members, everybody took charge, problem solved, and literally reinvented trauma care in about 12 years and cut combat casualty death rate to the lowest in world history. It's all about leadership. So thank you.
Responder leader, and each of the panelists is going to present for a few minutes
We get sort of a taste of their leadership style and some of the things they've been involved in, and then we're going to have some time for questions and answers. And my hope, again, since the purpose of this is to talk about leadership stress, that we'll hear a little bit about our leaders, some candid comments about the stresses that they experience from their roles as leaders. And if they don't make those in their remarks, it is an opportunity to ask about it. That's, we don't like to necessarily talk about our own personal struggles, but I think it's an important aspect of leadership that we, and I think the Admiral talked about, kind of get the handle on your own emotional intelligence, what makes you put you in the wrong place when you're in, should be leading. So I think it's an opportunity to learn about how our accomplished leaders have dealt with this challenge. What I'm going to do is briefly introduce each of the panelists. I'm going to keep my introductions brief because your program has them in detail, and I don't want to too much tread on their time. I do want to make one specific mention that Captain Ingrid Pauly, who was the Director of Psychological Health for the Navy's Bureau of Medicine, who was listed on your program, unfortunately was not able to make it today. We have a great pinch hitter for her in Mr. Gabriel, and I believe we have his biography. He's going to speak back clean up here for our panel. No pressure, Mr. Gabriel. But I'm going to start out with Lori Upton. And Lori is the Director of Regional Preparedness for Southeast Texas Regional Advisory Council. She's authored the disaster, she's proud of her authorship of the disaster chapter of the Emergency Nurses Pediatric Course, fourth edition. She's a national and international speaker on developing and integrating medical disaster planning response. She's been involved in numerous incidents, some of which we've already heard about today. Hurricane Andrew in Florida, September 11th in New York. She was served as the medical operations chief for Hurricane Rita, Katrina, Gusta, Ike, and Harvey in Texas. She's been busy in Texas. It's terrific that she's here to join us. She's got some slides to present. We'll let her do that. Maybe take one question or two, and then we'll save the rest of the panel discussion, if that's okay. So, Lori, thank you for joining us. Everyone will see.
Thank you. Thank y'all for inviting me here today. I just have very few slides, but I just wanted to be able to set the picture as to what Hurricane Harvey was. I don't know if anyone in this room would have been touched on myself. Were at and deployed over to the Houston area during Harvey. A couple folks. So you understand what we're talking about here. The numbers are staggering when you look at it, the amount of rain that fell in the greater Houston area. When I talk about the greater Houston area, I'm going to talk about the 25 counties. It's 25 counties that our Medical Operations Center serves. And they're all mainly on the Gulf Coast of Texas. We go from two-thirds the way down the Texas Gulf Coast all the way up to Louisiana, and then about four counties in. Harvey affected 23 out of our 25 counties. So we had a large swath of land that we were trying to cover. We also coordinate over 900 nursing homes and 185 hospitals. So they're all being coordinated through the Medical Operations Center. Just to get a little idea there. The 25 counties encompasses about 277 different jurisdictions. And in Texas, the mayor and the judge are gods in our areas, and so they each have the authority to say what's going to happen in their area, so it's very important for them to work together when you have a city and a county working together. 9.3 million people are in those 25 counties, and we have about 877,000 individuals that have self-identified as having a medical special need in our community. About two-thirds of the state of Texas of the medical needs people all live within those 25 counties. Just to kind of get your head wrapped around that medical component. The amount of rain that fell, the imagine covering South Carolina with 20 inches of rain. The entire state of South Carolina with 20 inches of rain. Or Connecticut with 40 inches of rain. The entire state is covered in that amount of rain. That's a lot of water. I mean, everything flows. In the state of Texas, everything flows through Houston. It's got to get to the Gulf. So not only do you have the rain, but you have the rain that's coming from up north, and that's falling into the Houston waterways as well. Our city basically became paralyzed. And when I say city again, remember it's 25 counties. We didn't even take the brunt of the hurricane. The hurricane occurred south of us, down the Corpus Christi Rockport area. We just happened to be at the very side of the storm that decided to come in and install and go in and come back out, loop around the Gulf, grab a lot more moisture, and come back in and hit us again. So that's how Harvey actually made his rounds through the Texas Gulf Coast. So not only do we have these hospitals that are in the affected area, the nursing homes that are in the affected area, the roadways are gone. There's no way to get a bus in there. If you had a plan to evacuate your nursing home, there's no way you get a vehicle in there because the rain came so quickly and flooded so quickly. So phone calls are being made. The head of the storm is going on. There is no civilian helicopters that can fly because of the ground, because of the weather. U.S. Coast Guard's in, U.S. military's in, Texas military's in. So we got all these folks flying through airspace. No idea where they're going. They're picking people up from their homes. They're picking people up from nursing homes that were picked up on boats and put over on freeways. And they're moving them to higher grounds. And there's no coordination going on between the local here and the higher ups here that came in to help us. The greatest fear during that time period, in the height of the storm, was that we would have a mid-air collision on one of our helipads. The Texas Medical Center is one of the largest medical complexes in the world, and there's very few helipads up there. There are many medical helicopters that fly up there. And since they're grounded, their helicopters are on their pads. So we did have several helicopters that were military-based flying on and landing on helipads that have been closed down by the FAA in our region because of the instability. So there's some issues there. So not only are you thinking about what's going on with my family, that's my picture of my son's house. They just moved into that house like 4 months before they were getting it together. Half of my staff lost their homes, but they're still working with us. People are being rescued by Good Samaritans. A lot of that water was electrified. So we had firefighters who were going in there could actually feel the currents going through their bunker gear. So you had to get them out of that, out of harm's way. People died going back to their homes to get their pets because the water had been electrified. And then to top it all off, as you're trying to get folks out of their nursing homes, you're taking calls from the community. You talked about social media earlier. Your phone number's going up to the Medical Operations Center if you need help, call these people. And we can't get out to you. We've got 300 ambulances, but they are about 50 miles outside of the city because they can't get in to the city because there's no way to get out of the waterways. We're reaching around over to Louisiana to get across the border because I-10 is flooded. And then we get contaminated water because there's sewage pumps go out in the city. Oh, and by the way, two chemical plants. One plant exploded twice. So not only do you have people trying to get rescued, now you're dealing with the next issue that's coming up. And we joked about it at the time, saying that if we wrote this as an exercise, we would all be yes, because it just can't happen like this. 57 tornadoes came out of this thing. Two reservoirs are breached, and the water has to be released. So if the flooding wasn't bad enough, now we have these reservoirs to flood additional areas that have never flooded before. And we've increased our needs exponentially. So these are just some pictures of the city before and after. Our freeways, and you can see, those are fairly high elevated roadways. Houston's got a very low, flat terrain. The state even asked us, tell us about the terrain in your area. I mean, we used to be rice fields. So you know it's boggy, you know it's low, it doesn't have a whole lot of area to flow into. Again, before and after, talk about folks trying to get out of their cars. So the question is, what do we do? Flashbacks of Katrina are coming up of when this water goes away, how many bodies are you going to find? And what are we going to do with them? And how are we going to keep ourselves from being out of this? Because when our group gets together, I've told them there's three things that we're going to do. The first thing that we're going to do is write for the patient or the community member. The second one is you're going to solve the problem, you're not going to pump the problem. And the third one is that we're not going to be on news. So those were our only rules, but do what's right, fix the problem, and don't be on news. So, transporting neonates to coordinate from the Houston area or the Beaumont area getting some helicopters to fly these neonates that are neonate capable into closer areas into Houston, whether it's Austin, Dallas, and then making sure that we have the coordination around the ambulances and the receiving hospitals. So what we do is we help coordinate those movements, getting the assets, finding the receiving locations, ensuring that folks are being matched up appropriately for the patient's needs so that they're only moving these people once. Because every time you move someone, especially those frail individuals, the chances of morbidity is greater. The picture over here is not the ocean, that's Interstate 10 that goes between Texas and Louisiana. So just as an idea of what it actually looked like in the height of the storm. And remember now, you've got phone calls, we've got 20 lines that go into our medical operations center and they're continuously ringing for people that are saying, I need help, I need to get out, we're taking in water. I can't get to you. These are the roadways that were closed during the height of the storm. So Houston is, they talk about, what is it, a traffic wheel. So it's like a big wheel, you've got a couple circles that go around it, and there's only four major freeways that go out of Houston to get all these folks out of here. So that I-10 on the far side, that's where our ambulances were stuck, before that entrance, trying to get into all of this area to save all these people. So it wasn't until the water started to go down and actually get ground crews into the area. This is where it's coordinated at, the Medical Operations Center. As you said in my biography, I serve as the Medical Operations Chief. And that's for that 25 counties, all of those hospitals, those nursing homes. We coordinate ambulance staging, so we ended up with 200 Texas ambulances and about 200 federal ambulances that come in. We had two air operation locations, three staging areas, but central and then two other outside. Mobile medical units were deployed out to these areas because hospitals were closed down and people couldn't get to them. So we find a high ground and transport, sometimes through C-130s, transport our medical folks out to that area with the tent and their jump bags to help provide medical care to those communities. This is a picture of our team. One thing that is, I think, is helpful for us is that we all agree to those three experiences in the beginning. We're going to do this right. We're going to solve the problem, not punt it, and we're not going to be in the news. So it's kind of nice when you're a bunker because you're not in the news, but your actions are going to be in the news. Every day, twice a day, we would have briefings. So they would start at 8 in the morning, we'd have a briefing again at 8 p.m. So we all work 12-hour shifts. I tried to keep folks together on their teams so they could build that camaraderie. They knew what the next person was going to do instead of continuously shifting new people into the mix. If that was important. Also, I gave every one of those individuals 2 days off. I need you to take 2 days. We were deployed for 18 days continuous. Take 2 days. I need you to go check in your home, check in your family, make sure your affairs are in order, because you can't care for this community unless you care for your family first. And then this is, they ask, you know, what is it like? And this is what it was like. So the briefings in the morning helped. The briefings at night help. During the middle of the day, we would have a phone call with our hospitals and our nursing homes to give them an overview of, here's the situation right now. Here's where we're going to, here's the issues that we've got. Here's what our missions are for today. Here's where we're thinking moving ahead for the next 24 hours. Do you have any questions? Do you have any concerns? Do you have any issues that we haven't addressed yet? And so those were held daily with all of our hospitals and our nursing homes. I think one of the biggest things I think that stuck with me was the buzzing in your head. And it took days for the buzzing to go away. You never noticed it until the group that was on shift, we rocketed into our trucks, our high profile trucks, and we all stayed in our warehouse. We built kind of a dorm in our warehouse. So trying to keep them together, you could decompress together, we would have meals at the warehouse together. And then the next morning, we go back to this the next day. But you never really identify that buzzing until you got that down. And then it just doesn't stop. It just continues to buzz. So, and that's what it all was this kind of stuff. That's my
sharing with us that we do want the opportunity to ask a question here. We're going to have some questions for sure at the end, because they're going to come back to this buzzer in your head. I know it. Do we have one for before we?
Yes. How effective was the prior relationships established by the hospital coalitions in solving problems?
It was excellent. So we've been working together as a coalition for a hospital coalition since 1997, before coalitions were around. We were part of the first Velocity groups. And then we've been through numerous disasters together, from receiving patients from Katrina to evacuating in Rita to Gustav and Ike. Ike was our biggest challenge. The other thing that helped us in Harvey was that we do an annual coalition exercise every year. And the exercise that year, last year, was a Category 4 hurricane coming into the worst area, coming into the Galveston area, and completely liberating all of the area that we just took out the Harvey. So we've got great relationships with our hospital CEOs, and many of those were on the phone calls. We had about 400, 450 people that would call in on these afternoon briefings. And you can tell that most of them were calling in a conference line from their hospital ESCs, so that everyone could hear what's going on at the same time.
Thank you. Good question. And again, another sort of emerging theme, just putting things together. Great relationships make for great leadership, too. And the importance of those, establishing those before the stuff hits the fan. Why don't you have a seat at the up front, unless you want to see Mayor's slides, in which case you can sit right back down there.
I'm going to, I hope you can hear the answer to that question and the comments, but we'll do better with the microphone down the road here. Mayor Shaw is going to join us next. The mayor comes to us direct from his own personal emergency this morning, chasing down an Uber driver that took off with his luggage. But he's recovered from that in time to present at our panel, so we thank him for that one. He's the executive director and local health authority for Harris County Public Health, which is the nation's third largest county with 4.5 million people. He's got a fair amount of education in his past at Vanderbilt, at University of Toledo, for medical school residency and fellowship at University of Texas, and he's on a number of international and advisory boards and committees. He did some time in Switzerland. That must have been a tough gig. Someone's got to do it, right? And he's going to also talk a little bit about his experience with disaster management, and hopefully we'll share a little bit about the challenges, the buzz or the non-buzz in his head as well. So please welcome Mayor Schaap.
Start off comment. So Lori mentioned
mention this, I'll do this very quickly, but Harris County is the third most populous county in the U.S. with 4.7 million people. It is spread over a size of the state of Rhode Island. If we were population-wise, we'd be between Kentucky and Oregon, somewhere between 27 and 29 as a county in terms of population size, but as geographically, Rhode Island would be the size. So we actually very much think about our community as a very large, complex, and obviously significantly diverse as well. And it's also important for us to be thinking about in public health oftentimes that we really believe strongly, and I'm sort of trained in internal medicine, worked 15, 20 years in clinical medicine as a PD physician at the VA hospital system. And so I'm very much versed with thinking about health care. But really, over the years and the real transformation of my career is really thinking that health doesn't happen just in the healthcare system, hospitals, clinics, EDs, but it actually happens in the community where people live, learn, work, worship, and play. And so we really believe strongly in that concept. And so while everybody thinks about healthcare delivery, this is really behind the scenes of what Public Health does, just a little bit about our department and just thinking about everything from restaurant inspections to doing environmental sampling, to spraying for mosquitoes, picking up dangerous animals like dogs, making sure that we are doing vaccinations, whether it's individual vaccinations or mass vaccinations during H1N1. I mean, there's a real gamut of what local public health across the system really does. And what I always say is that public health is really the offensive line of a football team. And I know people have heard me say that, but I feel very strongly that the draft is coming up tomorrow, or, today, actually. The NFL draft, and everybody is going to be thinking about the quarterback. In fact, that's all you're hearing about, the quarterbacks and running backs and wide receivers that are going to be picked. But nobody's really so excited about that offensive lineman that's going to be picked, but absolutely critical to the success of that football team. And I really believe strongly that that's how public health is, that largely invisible, yet absolutely critical to the success and well-being of the community. Lori touched on this very, very quickly, and I will do it very quickly as well. But just to let you know that we do, as part of public health, have an ESF 8, Emergency Services Function 8, responsibility, and that includes a lot of things in here, which is really essentially health and medical. It's really health and medical for as part of our county plan about what we're going to do in the midst of an emergency and all the different things that we're going to be doing that's going to allow us to be everything from interfacing with Setrac and Lori's group, talking with hospitals, hospital institutions, healthcare institutions, but everything in between, which includes Functional Needs Medical Refuge, an FNMR that was set up to basically say that folks who were not able to get out of evacuation zones but had medical needs, we would set something up for them. And everything to surveillance in shelters, mass shelters that were created, so we would do cop to cop surveys every single night to prevent infectious disease outbreaks. But then in the community, doing all sorts of surveillance activities related to the needs of the community, and then certainly thinking about how we can coordinate a lot of the different activities that had impact on health and medical. By the way, that were not just health and medical, they were education, and schools, and I'll remember live, learn, work, worship, play, thinking about all those sectors as well. Unfortunately, and again, this is alluded to, we could make the comment, we need to move from Houston, we haven't. We have had a lot of emergencies in our community. And it goes all the way back to Tropical Storm Allison in 2001. These are just a list of some of them, not even all of them. But as you know, that there are a few here that I'm going to be highlighting: Hurricane Katrina response, Hurricane Rita response, Hurricane Ike response, H1N1, Ebola, and Zika, and Hurricane Harvey. Now think about that. That's just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 out of a whole list that goes all the way back to 2001 with Tropical Storm Allison, which we thought was the worst of the worst until we had Hurricane Ike and Harvey and all sorts of other storms, but also thinking about being the first biowatch hit city in the country, all of the infectious diseases and even chemical and other kinds of emergencies that we've had throughout our community. So it's busy in our community, and that's what we are, I believe, very good at responding, because we unfortunately have had a lot of practice at it. So here's some images, just to refresh back to Hurricane Katrina. Thinking about 2005, right, 27,000 people at the Astrodome. I,
I was just fresh out of being in the ED, and all of a sudden I was kind of put into public health, and here I was as the co-medical branch director of this 27,000 person operation in 2005 when I had hair. It wasn't all, I had hair, that's the first thing, and it wasn't all gray. And you know, the buses that were coming off, and the triage that was done, and the multiple buses that were coming off, and really building a city that we had to do for several weeks in order to create the conditions so people could actually be healthy and safe. Followed 6 weeks later by Hurricane Rita, where we said, everybody get out of town, and people they listened, right? It was on the heels of Hurricane Katrina, and guess what? They got into the freeways, got stuck, and unfortunately we had a lot of negative issues that occurred, adverse outcomes that happened when people were evacuated, but the storm never hit us, right? It went east of us. A few years later, the storm did hit us. It actually hit Galveston and Houston-Harris County, and so we had about 90%+ of our community that had without power, 96% at one point, for several days to weeks, and some of those images of what was going on at that time during Hurricane Ike response. And you fast forward to then 2009-2010, right on the heels of, right, we finished Hurricane Ike, and the next thing you know, we had something called H1N1, and we were in emergency response for 18 months. Similar to many health departments across the country, really thinking about what we need to do from an infectious disease standpoint. And then Ebola, right? So Ebola happened in West Africa, where we know the first case in the continental US was in Dallas. Dallas is not far from Houston, and we call it the popcorn effect. Everything that was happening in Dallas was happening in Houston. Every time the health department there or anybody was making any comments or issues, they would ask us questions, right? And the questions that were coming in, is it safe for the for Houston Texans fans to go to Dallas to watch the Cowboys and the Texans play? Because obviously Ebola is everywhere in Dallas. I mean, those are the kinds of questions that we were getting. But again, it was readiness because we had zero cases of Ebola in Houston-Harris County, but it felt like we were in the midst of response. To follow up in 2016-2017, where we've had Zika, and again, one of the real challenges in our community is just the weather and obviously the mosquitoes and the kinds of vectors to really have those kinds of challenges, which went on the heels of West Nile virus and dengue and chikungunya and then Zika in the midst of it. So we were fighting the bite, preventing the bite day and night with our mosquito control program. But nothing was like having the National Weather Service issue this, which is, this event is unprecedented and all impacts are unknown and beyond anything experienced. Can anyone guess which event NWS was talking about? Hurricane Harvey? Hurricane Harvey. Mr. Gabriel is absolutely correct, Hurricane Harvey. It's usually not what you want to hear from anybody, right? Lori's absolutely right. This was not a storm that hit our community directly. This was in southern part of Texas, Corpus Christi. The weather pattern came up. There was a high pressure system in New Mexico, sort of pushed it back. It stalled instead of just going in inland and dissipating, and went up the coast. And the next thing you know, we had 4 to 5 days of rain straight. Rain. And as you saw in that sort of never a dull moment, in 2016 Memorial Day floods, 2015 Memorial Day floods, 2016 tax day floods, these were 100+ year events 2 years in a row. And then we had Hurricane Harvey, which was an 800 year event from that standpoint, and a 2,000 to 5,000 year rain event. Think about that. You should not be getting this every so often. At some point, a third of Rhode Island was underwater. Think about that. A third of Rhode Island was underwater. We had an incredible amount of infrastructure damage. Amazingly, still too many, but amazingly 36 fatalities. But the amount of water, a trillion gallons, in that beautiful picture that Lori showed, of a trillion gallons of water, you put that on a community, and you do get what Lori again showed earlier, which is this incredible imagery of just water everywhere. Amazingly, we were able to get through this, but we're still in this. We're still in that recovery phase. So I said earlier that health happens where you live, learn, work, worship, and play. Hurricane Harvey hit us where we live, where we learn, where we work, where we worship, where we play. So it was incumbent on us as a health department to respond in all of those areas, and absolutely critical to those successes. And I can talk a little bit about some of those. J.J. Watt, J.R. Atkins, EMS responder, J.J. Watt, who's much taller than me, to really be thinking about how we'll be able to get through that. But our department really, at the end of the day, was very much about the multi-faceted response that was really about the One Health concept. We had environmental health, entomology, animal health, and human health all in one umbrella, so we leverage it every single time in the midst of an emergency. So everything from coordination to community engagement to disease surveillance, operations in the shelter, mosquito activities, but including the U.S. Air Force that did aerial spraying, and we can talk more about that, environmental health, animal management, and mobile service delivery. Our tagline was taking public health to the public. When our community is not mobile, I will be mobile for the community. So these are some of those images. This is what gets most of the attention. This is NRG, the Astrodome complex. This is the 10,000-person shelter that was there. That's what everybody thinks about. That's what everybody thinks about. All the behind-the-scenes things, but still, it's very in your radar, on your radar. But this is the community side. This is the setting up of 8 or 9 RV units that we invested in. We can talk about that, but really putting those together to do outreach into the community, and even going door to door to knock on people's doors and ask what their needs were, and then provide them with services, including CASPER, which is a surveillance system through the CDC, to get volunteers to be able to do that in the community. And our role was also being the voice of that community. And so this is an incredible quote: statistics are human beings with the tears wiped off. And I think that's a really important piece, because it was really about those stories about people that we met when we were in the community. Because people weren't coming to the health system because they were too busy sweeping and cleaning and remodeling. But that's what we were seeing in the community. It was really this opportunity to be thinking about, and you can't see at the bottom there, that it says 2,200 miles in 10 days, is that essentially I drove 2,200 miles in 10 days, knocking on doors and talking to people. And as you do that, you start to realize that there is a real opportunity for thinking about what is really happening in a community. And that right there is in the middle, and it's actually a video. Can you click on that real quick? That's what it was about. That's what we faced for 4 or 5 days. Rain. And those pictures right there are actually my neighborhood. My own family went from voluntary evacuation to mandatory evacuation in 6 hours, and we had to get on an SUV to try to get on sidewalks to get out, and we got stuck. We had to get pulled out. We had to evacuate the SUV with elderly people, one person in a wheelchair, et cetera, et cetera. It's very intimate for all of us. This is not just it happened in a vacuum. This was our own community, our own family. So really taking public health to the public, really, really believe that the role of local public health just makes common sense. That comes from that Katrina picture in 2005 in the middle of the night when we weren't asking for more widgets, things, but really common sense and official ISO 2.214. And I'm just going to close with this last piece. It's this last video that just really captures the incredible amount of real work that we did during this response, and then I'll sit down and we can have a conversation.
Is this the video here?
Oh, it's the very bottom, above the 23 on the left.
Thank you.
helped really set a stage here. I appreciate that. We have one more speaker. We're going to give Dr. Shaw one question before we get to our panelists. Does somebody have a question for Dr. Shaw? I promise I have some for you. Keep the faith. And last and by no means least, he doesn't have slides. That doesn't matter. So he can speak. Mr. Ed Gabriel. Mr. Gabriel is the Deputy Assistant Secretary, serving as the advisor to the Assistant Secretary for Preparedness and Response for Department of Health and Human Services. And he advises on, of course, matters pertaining to and in support of the Department's public health, emergency preparedness, and response recovery activities and policies. He's done it all in terms of crisis response and managing crisis response. I'm hoping he can help us set a little bit of a stage here in terms of thinking about the stressors on the leader. You know, we saw the pictures of the stuff you're dealing with. What's the stuff in your head? And how are you managing that?
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us.
So, it's great to be here. I'm sort of the last minute fill in that called me last night. And I appreciate I was actually coming to the conference just to listen.
Nobody goes unpunished.
And I don't have slides, but I do have to tell you, so looking back at the things that we talked about today, I can tell you the perspective I have isn't necessarily consistent with the perspectives that the other people present on. My career has been a first responder, so I'm going to give you a perspective of actually being at the incidents as they occur from the field level, and then talk about it as how it morphs into a sort of a regional response. Everything that, for the years that I've been doing this, it's been a really long time, and you all have probably seen my bio, I want to tell you that no incident at all, which is a common theme for all of our speakers, no incident is ever managed by yourself. So the fact that you think you're in charge of something during an event means you cannot operationally functionalize that without having good teams of people around you. My experiences are there are always good people around you. From the 93 bombing, which I was at the World Trade Center, to being in Tower 1 on September 11th, I saw more heroic acts by individuals with no medical experience as I did with individuals with medical experience. I saw people running towards events, and all that means is we have to do a better job of making them prepare to deal with that during a response. Personal experiences have shown me, if you look at the Boston bombing videos, and I was not there. Trouble has followed me pretty much my whole life, but I certainly wasn't there. But you saw not only police and firefighters and EMS people running towards those events, but you saw bystanders by their sides running towards those events. Now, on September 11th, I saw cab drivers in New York City picking patients up and asking us, where do you want to take? And I saw boats coming to the west side. No plan for that to remove patients and people off to New Jersey. No plan for that. And then you saw how well it worked when we had the Scully incident with that airline, that U.S. airline. That was a predetermined plan after September 11th. They all had similar radios and codes. Because we realized, holy poop, excuse me for a word, but I know that. Holy crap, this could happen again. And in fact, it did. So I can tell you, when you look at the response and the leadership around response, just as you all go back from here, realize every incident has a medical impact. That's really who we're trying to take care of, right? We're trying to take care of the people that, without power, are on dependent technologies at home. We're trying to take care of people. We're trying to take care of people that are, I was dancing to it, I don't know what song it was. Mine is, So when you look at the overall responses to things, remember, and I try to tell our people all the time, medical response does not operate in a vacuum. It always operates in cooperation with everybody else. Institutions like nursing homes, that unfolds stuff that's happened across the company when you get flooding. The chances of moving those patients out are part of an overall response. I've been through nursing home fires and I've moved people out in the middle of the winter, around 110 people from one nursing home. Every time you do that, even in the power outage event in New York City, it's still putting all those patients at risk, right? You gotta figure out where they're gonna go, who's gonna move them, how are you gonna move them? All those things are problematic. Let me go to September 11th for a second and just talk about leadership. And ask one question. After it occurred, who was in charge? Was it the federal government? Was it the states of New York and New Jersey? Was it the Port Authority? Was on the states of New Jersey? Or was it the city of New York? Who was in charge? Who wants to answer that? Come on.
All the above.
Who?
All the above.
You would say all the above. Who was in charge?
City.
The mayor of the city of New York. Now, he wasn't really in charge. He wasn't. But he took that leadership role because he had practiced it. Because he didn't go into that circumstance being a political guy who never practiced response. He actually practiced response, and we challenged our leadership before that. Now, we made mistakes. I'm going to talk to you about them in just a second. The key is the whole country knew who was in charge. Meanwhile, behind the scenes, we had Thad with his people guarding our waterfront, and that's when I first met him. We had resources from military on ground helping protect our streets. We had stuff flying over Ground Zero that was so classified that we didn't even know it existed, because back in those days nobody had clearances at the lower levels of the city of New York. So we had stuff flying over Ground Zero and could look down into the pile to see where we needed to find people. We had no idea that technology existed. But the emotional use of all of that stuff during September 11th put an impact both in the cities, the communities, and the states. Because it was an impact that every time we flew a plane over Ground Zero, everyone flipped out, the whole city of New York. We then realized we probably emotionally have to announce that. Because we're going to fly a plane over a place that was attacked by two planes. So subsequently, you know, you don't think like that. From a leadership perspective, you're thinking, this is great, let me get it over the property. And then we had looky-loos. Anyone from California? That's like a rubbernecker if you're in East Coast. You know, when you drive past something you want to see. So we didn't control the airspace, we were the city of New York. But everybody wanted to see Ground Zero. So they kept flying aircraft. Now some of it was protective aircraft, right? From the Air Force flying over to keep us safe. We like that. But we still have to announce that, especially if they came in low. Helicopters over the site, small planes trying to get into the area. All of that was very problematic for us at the level of leadership. I want to just say a couple of things. Ebola, I was a Fed during Ebola. What a different perspective being a Fed than it is for being a local. I have to tell you, I learned a lot of things. But you brought it up. The reality is Ebola was a press story in the United States. It got very big and very visible. You know, we had particular states, and you saw it. We had particular states, and remember, our states are independent. Even at leadership at the federal level, we had individual states making decisions on whether or not a plane with an Ebola patient could land in a state to refuel. It's either going to fall out of the sky or land and get refueled. We had hours worth of discussion while those planes were in the air, just to allow that to happen. The federal removal of waste and the decision-making around that, where could it go? Most of the medical people in the community said, treat it like biological waste. You do that all the time in hospitals, right? You know, my wife's a nurse, so she gave me nothing but crap about us trying to treat this differently than any patient that may have tuberculosis or some other blood-borne disease. Yet, somebody was developing a standard at the federal level that we moved that patient's waste, no pun intended, from Bellevue, 8 states to dispose of it. We ended up with you guys. Well, again, I'm just making that up. So when I talk to people about prioritizing these kinds of responses and being a leader, I'm just going to say a couple of things that are sort of just my perspective of how to manage. Be innovative. fine, as the Admiral said before, attorneys give opinions, and I have a few attorneys in the family. Listen to them, but you want to get to yes if you believe it's the right thing to do. You don't want to listen to no if no is not right. The second thing I've learned from my experiences are communicate consistently. Now, what do I mean by that? You saw when the Admiral was talking, but let's go back to the World Trade Center. Two press conferences a day, always led by the leader, which was the mayor, surrounded by his partners from the states and the federal government, with experts that answer questions. Let me give you the pattern of craziness around that time. Who was anybody from New York here? Was there hearts here? So you get September 11th, you get anthrax cases a month and a half later, and you get a 757 crashing into the Rockaways. Everyone in New York believed that was all connected. You could not pacify the emotional distress on New Yorkers when you think about that, and probably the community around that. You have to be nervous, right? Anthrax cases, 757 crashes into one of the five boroughs. And by the way, if you looked at it on television, during this giant thing in Madison Square Garden, I didn't get to watch it, I was working, but one of the fire guys said, you know, we're mad, and you'd have to come out the Rockaway to deal with us. But that plane crashed in the Rockaways. So someone thought it was a purposeful attack. And I was at that scene too. And I was at all the anthrax scenes. There were physicians who worked with me, they're not here now, to give out medicines during that. And we switched because the CDC said doxycycline would work on this. So we went from ciprofloxacin to doxycycline, and the emotional stress from all those patients were, why aren't you giving me the good stuff? Why are you giving me the crap? You ran out of the good stuff, right? So you're putting us at risk, this stuff's not gonna work. And none of them took it anyway. So in the end, very few people took the 30-day courses of the antibiotics at all. So, again, communication is important. So how do you get there in terms of this kind of stuff? Some suggestions. You're all health people. You need to be connected to the response people because they control a lot of the toys. They control pretty much the ambulances in some cases, some of the first responders, the fire engines, the cops, the police department. If you think about the resources from where I came from in New York City, there's 25,000 cops, maybe more now. There were 50,000. That's a pretty big unit of people, right? Second thing is when you set up as a leader, you need to surround yourself with good people. And I think Thad talked about it, and he and I have had this discussion. And you need to surround yourself with good people that are not afraid to give you advice. Because if you don't do that, you'll make a mistake. And I've seen that happen. I was at command post in the middle of a field, there was some green truck, it was flipped over, stuff was flowing out of it, and a little bit of a spray. And all those big shot chiefs at the command post said, we're going to go up there, and the fire operations chief was going to put some water on it. And up to the command post comes this person in the turnout gear, seven levels below my rank. And she looks at the chief and she says, Chief, what are you doing? And he's sending five people up to put water on it. And he says, I put some water on it, I was setting that team up. And she says, I didn't do that. And we asked her why. And she said, all the hazardous materials, lieutenant, and I know you're all big shots, these stars and stuff. But you know what? You don't know what you're doing. So you put water on it, it's going to blow a hole in that highway and kill those guys. Because you shouldn't ask me. I was the hazardous materials lieutenant. So you see what I mean? Mm-hmm. Surround yourself with good people. Make sure they're able to talk to you. Challenge. How many of you have done tabletops? Come on, all of you, right? You'll love that, don't you? I'm going to tell you a story that you won't hear except for me. So it's before September 11th. We're doing a tabletop with all the leadership in New York City, and it's a plague exercise. The dreaded plague, which, as you all know, the medical people, is transmissible. It's infectious. We've got it in Lower Manhattan. That's what the scenario is, right? I'm the facilitator of the exercise. All the big shots are on the table. Mayor, deputy mayors, health commissioner. I forget his name. He's a great guy. And during the scenario, we have that old discussion we used to have that we don't really have that much anymore about quarantine versus isolation, right? So the question is, okay, you get shots. By the way, this is a failure if you let this go past you when you're in your exercise mode, right? Challenge, challenge, challenge. As leaders, challenge the answers. The health commissioner says, yeah, we can quarantine over Manhattan. It's before September 11th, there's 500,000 people in lower Manhattan, right? So, we start to move on. Everybody accepts that. On the bed guy in front of the room, I go, let's talk about how we're going to do that. So the police chief, who's an old friend, and he just retired a little while ago, so I can tell the story. He says, yeah, we can do it. I've got thousands of cops. I'll put them on all the entrance ways. And some high-ranking federal person in the room says, well, putting them there, would they force the crowds back? I mean, they could be exposed to plague. How are you going to do that? And he goes, sure, we could force them back. We're just getting this protective order. We would do that. So I'm the facilitator. And the mayor's not really buying this. You know, he's got that icky face on, like, how are we really going to do it? So I asked the question, so chief, how are we really going to do it? And he gave me a dirty look because he was an old friend. And he said, Ed, here's how we'll do it. Kidding around completely. I'll put some cops on the Brooklyn Bridge, we'll try to walk over, we'll shoot them, they'll build up a natural barrier. The point for that conversation is, challenge them. The answers are on tabletops, people don't get there right away. It's fantasy if you don't push it. And as leaders, you need to challenge that. Don't let it go past because it's somebody who's going to give you a BS solution when you try to run into it in real life. BS. And you try to run into it in real life, it does not work. Right? So just challenge that. Just be that kind of person that challenges that. And the last thing I'll tell you about, and then I'll just sit down and be quiet. The major events that I've gone to in real life, the one thing we forget, which is so important that we shouldn't forget, is the emotional impacts that has on everyone. From the local response person, who's probably not going home for a long period of time, like you were discussing. The impacts on all of the staffs that touch patients. The impacts on the community that's affected by the disaster. In Lower Manhattan, thousands of people displaced. The impacts on the people that are missing relatives and how you manage them. And then the emotional impacts on the whole community. Like I told you this, afraid when an airplane takes off and lands. I'm going to end with one little story. After September 11th, we had so much emotional need by the community to see the site that they were tying up a response. And, you know, if you were like an old, I wasn't that old then. But if you were a seasoned emergency response person, you said, can't waste your time for that. That's not important. But tens of thousands of people, citizens, were showing up at ground zero, either trying to help or just wanting to be close to the site. There was some emotional draw to that site that I had never seen in my career. Finally, some people with level heads as leaders decided, hey, a way to manage that. Why don't we put up a viewing stand on one side of ground zero? And then why don't we put up another stand where the big shots from all over the world want to come and allow people to come see the site? We'll move them along, give them access. All the complaints around people not having the ability to be attached to the incident and wanting to be close, that natural feeling from all over the country, started to go away once we built those viewing sites. And gave out a certain amount of tickets per day. And I know it sounds silly, but it's not as silly as the last thing I'm going to tell you. I'm at that one of those sites at ground zero, and a woman comes up to me. And she's like us, civilians or military people. She's got three kids. She can't go back to her apartment. Five apartments won't allow her to have it. Stages, glasses, all around. And she says to me, my kids won't sleep. They're all young kids. They all have, they have these little dolls they sleep with. She said, we left the houses and the dolls were on. They won't sleep without them. And they're driving me crazy. And they're driving lots of people crazy. Can you help me get them? And my initial response was, come on, lady, give me a break. And then I thought about it. I said, in real life, the stresses of not being in your apartment, the stresses of not having a place to live, the stresses of your kids being up because they can't go to sleep. I spoke to a fire friend of mine. I said, can you get, go to this apartment and get that stuff for us? And he did. And she wrote like a wonderful letter to Boston, the fire department, thanking us for just taking the time out to make her life a little bit better. That's an emotional impact that none of you would have thought about, I didn't think about until that day was over. True story. Anyway, thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. We are delighted that we got to hear such a great recapitulations of some horrible and complex situations, and we really do want to focus a little bit here on how you dealt with them as you. I noticed a recurring theme across almost every one of our presenters about lack of hair. Well, not all of them mentioned it. Some of them mentioned it. I observed it in all but one, so she must be doing something right. The rest of us need to learn from. But there must be more to managing stress than shampoo. So please, questions from the audience here about how these great leaders have dealt with their own stress. Anything for the group? Got one from Tom. Sir.
So we're hearing about different ways or different involvements in disasters. And a number of us in the room, I think, have been involved in disasters and have struggled through those. Are there any simple answers for anyone for managing your own stress in these? Because it's a very complex thing that goes on. Are there simple recommendations that we can make to the audience that we can do on a daily basis, on an hourly basis in these responses?
I mean, I'll just say one thing, and that is, so your routine is done, right? So for the duration of the disaster, if you got up every morning and ran, normally, that routine is done. And it's up to leadership to find ways to sort of, if you're in a stressed environment and you're surrounded by it, to do that. And I'll give you an example of one. The Operations Center in New York City, after September 11th, with all the federal agencies and state and local, it's at 170 agencies, and about 500 people in it. That's how big the operations of PIER. Was where they docked the QE kit. And we had a discussion with then the leadership of the city, and we actually married someone in the center of the operations center. A, because they asked, not even married, not just in the case, but that we literally married some college sweethearts that had been separated from each other, who met again during a disaster in the center of the operations center. And morale, you could feel the morale of the operations center that had been open for months changed. That we just took the time and effort to do something fun in there. Didn't get a lot of publicity. We didn't bring in the media, closed the doors, but everybody who was in there knew this couple, and we married them. So little things like paying attention to yourself and health and the well-being of the people around you is important, forcing people to take breaks, those kinds of things. I think anything can change the mood and make it positive. Same thing happened in the streets. There's a famous picture of a couple of three or four women standing in the middle of West Street with signs thanking response people during September 11th. The police department initially moved them. It caused such an uproar that they let them come back, and the crowds grew bigger and bigger and bigger. And I talked to a number of the people that we sent for peer discussions afterwards. And they thought that that was such a powerful thing when they were going and coming from sites to have the community out there supporting them. And I know it sounds like silly little stuff, but it's huge in terms of morale. And by the way, it helped my morale too. It helped my psyche during all this.
I think for myself, ever since my kids were little, we used to always get up earlier before they would get up, so we'd have that little bit of moment in the morning. Those of you that are moms, you're shaking your heads. When you can have my coffee, I can look over what the day is going to look like. And so finding that little bit of normalcy in the middle of your deployment or in the middle of your crisis.
get up a little bit early in the warehouse, I'd put up a pot of coffee, I would go stand outside because we had a little awning so you could see Lorraine still, and pretty soon, almost like family, the rest of my team would start wandering it down because they would smell the coffee, and then we could like bond together and then go on with our day.
Yeah, I just echoing what has just been mentioned by Ed and Lori is that we always talk about in the clinical setting when you're running a code to take your own pulse first. You don't want to be in the midst of your own emergency, and so I think that's really critical to the whole operation. But really finding those moments that you disconnect, and there are times where you have to disconnect. You just cannot continue to go 24/7 for weeks on end. And while the response goes on like that, you have to find the disconnection point. And the final thing that I would say, in addition to birthdays and other things that staff members might have that gives you that little bit of a real respite, is remember why you're doing it. And I know that you heard some fantastic stories here from my colleagues, and I think the biggest thing is to say that you have to remember why you're doing this in terms of going with the people that you're serving. And so when we were in the midst of Katrina, or all the way up to the latest in Hurricane Harvey, or even global from Haiti to Kashmir, is the child, is the boy, is the girl, is the person, the elderly individual. One, you go in the middle of the shelter of 27,000 or 50,000 or 5,000 or 200 and just asking people what they need. And sometimes you take off your hat of being the top responder, whatever that role is, and actually just sit down with somebody and just have a conversation about how it's personally impacting them at the ground level. That can do incredible wonders to focusing you back into why you're there.
Thank you. I think that word is right.
I've noticed that Admiral Allen made a comment sort of setting a limit or a boundary for himself on several occasions where he sort of alluded to the idea that if you want this job, you can have it, but this is a limit that I'm not willing to cross. And even though he didn't talk about that specifically, that I recall in the context of an aspect of how he managed his own well-being, I'm wondering if you all have situations either for yourself or that you have observed for other people or sort of becoming clear or creating a sense of clarity around what are lines that you are and are not willing to cross in a fog of political issues and changing landscape of things that in some way has played a part in your own well-being, or if there's a place for that in one's well-being, sustaining well-being, particularly these protracted types of experiences.
So for those in the back, just to quickly recap it, it was the, sort of the issue of setting some sort of personal boundary, some line of things that you are or are not willing to do, and the role in having some clarity on that and maintaining sanity and managing one's own stress.
So I'll take a first shot at it and just say that everybody has their ethical line, right? So the ethics piece is really critical, right? So if you're doing something that you feel is beyond what you ethically can do, or you don't believe in the mission anymore, then obviously you need to pull back. But the one thing that I would really suggest is that we all have theoretical lines of where we believe this is our limit. And I mean in terms of a response, that this is what I would do theoretically if I were in the middle of a response. I'll be very honest, when things are coming at you at 100 miles per hour, in the midst of an emergency, and that's really what is happening. It's happening fast. You oftentimes get pushed to those lines, and sometimes you feel that what you, prior to an emergency, had felt you were going to be doing with your family. I have three children, for example, what I would be bringing to the table, how much I would be disconnecting, that maybe I would never theoretically think I would do that. In the midst of an emergency, actually, that's exactly what I had to do. The line starts to move a bit. And I think what you have to have the wisdom is to know that there you're moving from an everyday activity to now an emergency response, and the line has shifted. There comes a point where if it has shifted so far that you no longer are comfortable with that shift, that's when you have to take that, what, like we said those breaks or those abilities to connect back with the rest of your world. And if that's not enough, then I really believe the advice is that you have to think about, what can I do to bring myself back into the line, to the part where I'm comfortable with? And I think it's really having those discussions with yourself when you're having coffee in the morning, or you're, you know, resonating with other folks as part of the response, is having those internal discussions about what's that line. And I'll be honest, when you're going 100 miles per hour, it's really hard to have those discussions, but you have to remove the noise from your head and really have those moments so you can have that. Because we are all mission focused. We remain committed to the people we serve, but there is a cost to that, and we have to just recognize that cost.
The thing I would add to that, and I agree completely, the thing I would add to that is there's different kinds of decisions, and some are very acute. You have to make an emergent decision. And I always try to think about when I've done that in my life, if I'm not agreeing with somebody who's recommending that change, that particular decision, is why are they not agreeing with me? If you take a little bit of time and think your way through that, you in fact may be wrong. You know, I sit around all the time with real experienced people with lots of knowledge in different areas. And their opinion is worth something. If you're going to include them in a very acute decision-making process where you just have minutes, then you need to have that relationship and have the right people around the table with you to help say to you, all right, you're a big shot, you've been through a lot of emergencies, you think you're that, but hey, this is the reason why that recommendation is. On longer-term decisions, I've seen bad decisions made around emergency disasters that are sometimes very politically oriented, just like that. And you have to stand your ground. You have to say, you try nicely if you get a little bit of time, but you have to say, that's not an acceptable approach. We've had times in a real life experience where we had something that occurred in a large borough, and I won't tell you when, because you know who was in charge, but somebody made a determination, the only people that would be allowed to go into this particular borough during this event would be police, fire, and EMS. And they published that without talking to us. And from an emergency management position, we had to go to meet with the people that made that decision quickly and say, you're nuts. Who's going to feed these people? I mean, what about the nurses, docs, and EMTs, and the people who work in hospitals that are going to take care of these people? We need some more flexibility. And, you know, that's talking through the power and to put your ass in the line. But if you don't do that, the impacts will be just horrendous. And I'm not a military guy. I spent all my time in emergency services. But sometimes those silly decisions occur. And if you're a leader, it causes you a lot of stress, but you really gotta stay with that. And then, just like that did at the military level, say, come on, that's silly.
I think I'm going to have the panelists sit in the front for efficiency's sake so we don't fall behind. So let me introduce the concept of this next panel. We've talked a lot now from the perspective of the responders, the leaders, etc. Now we're going to turn a little bit more to the scientists, to the people who have not only been there, but also do the research, do the teaching, do the studies and analysis necessary to improve this setting. And so let me turn to the panel. I think I'll introduce them all together and then we'll go through their talks. So let me introduce the panel and then we'll move on to the first talk, which will be from slides. Immediately next to me is Susan Schmidt. She's a Senior Project Director for the Veterans Emergency Management Evaluation Center in the Department of Veterans Affairs.
I'll continue. Sorry, my mic was
wasn't working. She co-developed the psychologic first aid for volunteer responders, which is an important tool that was piloted originally in San Francisco and is now used around the country. She's taught disaster behavioral health and stress management for first responders, the public, health staff, and social employees. She's also helped support emotionally refugees, at-risk youth, and disaster survivors. And she holds a master's degree in international disaster psychology. Next to her is Dr. Jerry Jacobs. He's a professor emeritus and director emeritus of the Disaster Mental Health Institute and served as the director from 1993 to 2017 as a professor at the University of South Dakota, which happens to be about 2 hours from my family homestead in northern Nebraska, so I know the area well. He received his PhD in clinical community psychology from the University of South Dakota in 1982. He's worked with organizations such as the American Red Cross, the American Psychological Association, the CDC, the Department of Defense, and the World Health Organization. He's personally responded to events such as the 9/11 terror attacks at the World Trade Center, the 2001 Gujarat earthquake in India, and the 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami and Hurricane Katrina. Dr. Dan Dodgen directs the Office of Operational Policy and Strategic Planning at ASPR, which is the Department of Health and Human Services. He's on the board of directors of the International Association of Applied Psychology and is a Harvard Senior Executive Fellow. He received the APA's Early Career Award in 2005 and was later elected a fellow as the APA. He served as an executive director of the White House to direct the National Advisory Group on Disaster Mental Health and has led our country's mental health efforts in many events, including Hurricanes Harvey, Irma, Maria, Katrina, and Sandy, as well as the H1N1 epidemic and the BP oil spill. And good news is he's also a licensed psychologist in DC, so if you guys want to talk about your anxieties, he's here for you. So let's turn to Dr. Jacobs first, who has some slides to present, and then we'll move on to Susan Schmidt and then Dan Dodgen.
I appreciate the opportunity to be here today. And part of what I've been asked to talk about is some of the practical things we talked about for self-care for managers in crisis situations. I usually talk about the importance of self-care for managers because the managers set the theme for everybody that works under their supervision. And if managers are working 24/7, and not taking the breaks and not getting the sleep that was talked about by some of the prior presenters, that all the people under them also want to work the same way. And I think about one politician who was running for office who proudly proclaimed that he had worked 48 hours straight in the recent disaster response. And that was true, but you could see the quality of his decisions decline across those 48 hours until he was just making stupid decisions. And so, it's important to have the self-care, and part of that process that I was specifically asked to address is the technical knowledge and then the practicing of good self-care. I was asked to talk about our curricula. We do have a doctoral program in clinical disaster psychology, been operating since 1997, and that is limited to students in our clinical program. But we were also asked to develop a program that could help those who weren't in our clinical program, and that's the graduate certificate in disaster mental health. We consider this basically the essentials. And this is a program that's completely available online, so people anywhere can take it. And we often do have class members who are in other countries around the world. The courses that we included, the necessary courses, crisis intervention, disaster mental health, surveying the reverse Indian disaster, and then they have to choose either traumatic stress or management in disaster mental health. But part of what we learned is that many of the students wind up taking both because they see the merit of both of those courses. Self-care is a very important piece of the puzzle, and when we talk about self-care in our academia, people often say, well, those are just common sense things. and they are common sense until you're in the midst of a crisis, when that stuff is coming at you 100 miles an hour, 24/7. And at that point, many people lose their balance, and they begin to stop the self-care. So we talked about the importance of this. I often say mom was right. You know, take breaks, eat well, get a good night's sleep. Those things are important, but it's also good to maintain a routine. Just talking about, you know, getting up a little earlier in the morning, starting the coffee, going through your nighttime routines before you go to bed, your morning routines. Of course, your daily routine can't be the same, but you can find those pieces of routine, and being able to practice the routine really helps maintain some balance. Taking breaks is terribly important. Getting adequate sleep. In the first formal disaster response in which we participated, the crash of Flight 232 in 1989, we called Red Cross and asked them if they'd like a response team, and they said, as many as you can, as quick as you can. Dr. Amy Covell and I took down 12 doctoral students, and after a couple of days, one of the leading disaster response people in the country walked up to me and said, do you know your students are total professionals? I said, well, I'd like to believe that, but why do you say that? He said, because they take breaks. At the end of the shift, they leave, they go home, they get a good night's sleep, they come back. When I try to give them an assignment that's beyond their capability, they say no. If it's something that simply is overwhelming to them because they've already got 10 assignments, they tell me no, and they tell me why. Said that's a total professional. So just, it wasn't their technical knowledge, but they're taking breaks, getting breaks, sleep, eating and drinking a healthy diet. A few years ago, I was asked to evaluate the psychological support program of the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies. And part of that process was calling country and regional delegations around the world, asking them how they manage stress in their operations. And one of the heads of the delegation I was really interested to talk to had one of their delegation murdered just a few days earlier. And I asked him how he dealt with that in this team. He said, what I always do, I took everybody across the street to the bar and I ordered them to drink until they collapsed. I wasn't particularly impressed with the strategy, but I said, as I understand it, several of your delegation are Islamic. He said, yeah, so? Well, the Islamic folks don't drink alcohol. He said, that's their problem, let them deal with it. Not the best strategy ever. Trying to get some exercise. Leaving at the end of your shift, the politician who worked 48 straight hours wouldn't leave. Support from and for family and friends, talking to those people that help you to keep stable. I know a lot of people who have gone out on major disasters and were divorced a few months later. Part of that, in each case, was because they never called home. They never got in touch with the family, and the family was worried about them, but they also didn't touch base with the people who were their normal day-to-day support. So the self-care is very important, and it's not an automatic kind of thing. Finally, I wanted to just make some comments about community-based psychological first aid. The term psychological first aid has been used to apply to all kinds of things, and basically I categorize them into either community-based or response team models. When you need to, it's certainly a good thing to go in after the event and try to help people learn about basic psychological support. But in the community-based model, you do it as a preparation technique. And we try to teach an entire unit about psychological support. If you are working in a hospital, we try to teach everybody in the hospital psychological support. We've been able to empirically demonstrate that this is a successful model. Entire fire rescue departments taking the training. That way they recognize the traumatic stress reactions, they recognize when somebody might need something more than some basic psychological support, and so we have a model in which everyone can provide support to each other and not have to depend on mental health professionals. The units that we talk about in this process are traumatic stress, worrying about traumatic stress, understanding what that is and how it differs from normal stress, active listening, which is a basic psychological support program, problem solving, instrumental assistance, how do you provide basic practical kinds of things to help people through, things like getting the doll, from the apartment. When we're dealing with life and death issues, how do we deal with that? How do we help people get through that? When and where to refer, because psychological first aid is not enough for every situation. And in the ethics, as one of the previous speakers mentioned, and indeed focusing on the importance of maintaining self-care. And so this is a model that's been practiced around the world by the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent. One of the references in the reference list that was available on the tables outside is for the book I published on community-based psychological first aid. And I want to emphasize that it's published by Elsevier, which is one of the top science publishers in the world, and they reviewed it multiple times with different peer panels and said, this is empirically based. Yes, this is empirically based. This is not something I wrote sitting in an easy chair in my living room saying, gee, I wonder what would happen if we did this. These are effective techniques. So those are the keys, I think, to practicing and managing the stress of a crisis response. And again, I think it's very important that the leaders take care of themselves and model that behavior for those whom they supervise. Thank you.
Psychological preparedness. And so I'm just going to give you kind of a brief overview incorporates three or four steps, which is first to anticipate challenging situations. So for those, okay, let me just ask, how many of you would consider yourself in a leadership position? Oh, wow, okay, great, almost everybody. And so how many of you think that you manage stress really well and absolutely zero problems, you never get tripped up when there's a challenging situation? Okay, for those of you at home, it's zero hands. So great, you've already are ahead of the game, because if we are 100% honest with ourselves, there are certain situations that can be really challenging for us emotionally. We're not always going to be able to perform at our 100% best when we're in a stressful situation. There are certain triggers that might present themselves that then don't necessarily allow us to be as focused as we want. It might cause us to pause or have trouble appearing calm, appearing competent when we're trying to lead our colleagues or we're trying to respond to an emergency. So once you can anticipate what those potential triggers or challenging situations are, we also want to imagine how we might react. What are my normal stress reactions? And how might those be exacerbated in a high stress situation like a disaster? How would I realistically, physically, emotionally, cognitively respond? And then we want to be able to describe what will you do in that situation to be able to manage those self-care techniques that we can use and practice beforehand, but then really implement in that moment, in brief, quickly, to be able to make sure that we're able to manage our own reactions, to then be able to manage the reactions of those around us, and lead and make sure that we're able to complete the mission that's in front of us. And then we're able to then use those three steps and repeat them to try and lower our own distress for the situation that we've identified before it ever happens. So the goals of trainings like this are to be able to increase your psychological readiness and also to practice that self-reflection that was mentioned earlier, to be more aware of how we will respond, and to be able to recognize what our reactions might be and practice effective coping skills before anything happens. It can reduce our stress, improve performance, and enhance different aspects of resiliency, such as self-efficacy, local locus of control, and positive coping mechanisms. And the really beautiful thing about mental preparedness is something that can be done with the team as well. So although it's really wonderful to be able to prepare ourselves to be able to handle distressing situations, it's wonderful if we're able to do it with our team. So having the discussion of how you can have a discussion with your teammates to be able to plan how can we reduce the emotional impact of a disaster, recognizing when our colleagues are going to be distressed or overwhelmed, what are their reactions. As one of our previous speakers has said, a lot of times the people who are going to know how you react to stress with people you work with day to day, they're going to see it in you, and they're going to see it in them. So talking that through beforehand, letting people know what your triggers might be, or how they can recognize if you're distressed or overwhelmed. And then speaking with your colleagues about what can we do? How can we build this into our plans? Just like you do when you're planning a disaster response, you can sit down with your colleagues and say, how are we going to be able to take care of ourselves and one another emotionally? How can we make sure that we have those breaks? You need to expect that I'm going to tell you to go home and take a 2-day break. These are some of the things that you can work together to plan out beforehand in order to make sure that you're taken care of during. And although the current research hasn't looked specifically at disaster mental health preparedness enough, there has been a little bit of research around it. In a 2017 literature review on mental preparedness and mental readiness, it found that although there are a few existing articles, those that have been published show a very positive connection between psychological preparedness and positive mental health after an event. And there seems to be a movement towards incorporating psychological preparedness into risk communication as well as civilian and community preparedness in general. In Australia, this is becoming more and more popular with cyclone preparedness as well as fire preparedness. So my time is basically up, but the ultimate thing that I want to leave you with is that when it comes to disaster behavioral health, at the end of the day, what's ultimately very helpful is to be able to incorporate into your training plans, your annual training plans for yourself as well as your colleagues, this idea of psychological preparedness, psychological first aid, and self-care. Thank you.
see everyone, the folks who are still here. I know that it's been a long day. And by the way, for everyone who's like over 5'10 in any of those seats, wow, I'm shocked at how little labor, because you know all of our officers are tall and you know strong and you know really 8 feet tall on the inside, right? So I was really surprised how little labor there is. I want to thank though everybody at USIS. I want to thank the folks at the National Center. Wow, it's so exciting to see the directions that they're taking. It is a long time FedEx member, you know, many years ago. It's super exciting to see. And I want to maybe expand a little bit beyond just emotional and mental well-being today. We've had some really, really good discussion of that. And I want to build on it. But when we think about psychological science, when we think about the things that impact our decision-making in disasters, it really goes a little bit beyond just sort of what we traditionally think of as kind of the role of psychology, right, which tends to be more the emotional well-being, which is super important, and I think both Jerry and Susan have really talked about that. But I want us to think maybe a little bit more broadly about how all these things intersect. So what I want us to do is start with your last job, right? Your most recent job. Let me put it that way, because it's never the last one. There's always more to do. But start with your most recent job. Think about your first day on that job. Oh, by the way, commending the people from Houston. I lived in Houston for 6 years, I got my master's and my PhD there, and the work that you guys have done and are doing to help that community recover, you know, Houston proud, so good to see. Now, what I was gonna say is think about your last job. Think about your first day on that job, the first decision that you had to make, the first time that you were faced with having to deal with something, all right? Whether it was having to penetrate the HR system, whether it was figuring out how to log your hours, whether it was having to direct people and make assignments. Think about your first time, right? Think about how you handled that, all right? Now, let's say if you're a typical person in a new job, you're probably a little anxious, a little reluctant, maybe to demonstrate how little you know about that environment, all of the things that are part of being in a new job, right? But you've just been hired, you want to make a good impression, you want to do a good job. So, what are the things that you did on those first few days, weeks, whatever, on the job, when you had to make a decision to do something? I want to hear from the audience a bit, or from everyone in the room. Like, what did you do that maybe you would do differently now? What are the things that people typically do when they're in a new setting that are mistakes that you want to avoid? Can anyone think of something? Not me? Wait, nobody makes mistakes. Am I the only one who makes mistakes on the job?
Say, overcompensate.
Okay, overcompensate, right? What about reluctance to ask for help? Okay, maybe trying to act like you know it all. All right, now let's go back a little bit. Let's say when you were a student, all right? Picture your student days. We'll say college era. All right, how did you handle problems then? How did you handle problems when you were a student? What were the ways that people addressed them? Okay. Sometimes you involve substances. I won't say who in the audience suggested that. What else?
You might ask a classmate or a professor.
Okay, you might ask a friend, someone, professor for help. What else? What about when you're super stressed out as a student? Let's say you've got a huge exam coming up in a couple of days and a paper due at the same time. What do you do? Drink a lot of coffee and stay up all night, all right? What are other things that people do? Okay, call your parents. All right. All right, now let's go back even further. When you're a child, all right, did I just break this? Okay, that's maladaptive coping, right? All right, now let's go back to your child. What about your child and you're under extreme stress? Now, that extreme stress as a child is different than as an adult, right? Maybe you're being bullied, or maybe you do have a big exam and a paper due. Or maybe there's something else going on. All right, what do you do as a child when you're faced with extreme stress? Hey, cry. You still say cry?
Yeah.
What else?
Act out.
Act out?
Right.
Throw a fit. Okay. Kick the dog, right? Maybe do other things, right? Act out, maybe run away from home, right? Depends on what the stressor is, all right? Now, why am I asking you all these things? Well, I'm asking you for a very basic reason. When you're a leader under stress, when you're a leader, period, everyone has two patterns of how they lead. One is their evolved pattern. It's the one that does everything with Jerry and Susan and everyone all day has been talking about, right? It's their evolved leadership. It's what they do, what they know to do. It's, you know, it's taking care of yourself, it's interacting appropriately with your subordinates, it's being concerned about their birthdays, it's, you know, all those great things. Everyone also has a primitive coping style, right? A primitive way that they handle stress. Now, I use the word primitive, you could use it, you could call it initial, whatever you want to call it. For most of us, that harkens back to the examples from your first day on the job, sometimes the examples from college age, and frankly, sometimes all the way back to childhood, right? And what were some of the things you talked about? Running away from home, using controlled substances, having a tantrum, overcompensating, calling a friend, calling mommy. Like, we all have different things that we do. But what we know is that in periods of extreme stress, what happens, right? A little neuroscience. Our more primitive brain functions are the ones that dominate, right? Although, if you read the neuroscience, it actually turns out that pretty much 99% of all of our decision-making is not happening at the cognitive level. It's really happening more at the instinctive level. We can talk more about that another time. But pretty much all of our decision-making is done at a kind of gut instinctive level. That is exacerbated under stress. So what happens is we know about all of these great things that we're supposed to do. There's not a person in this room, and certainly all of our great speakers that have been here today, who couldn't write down for you the 10 most important things to remember when you're leading in a crisis. You know, the importance of collaboration, the importance of coordination, the importance of taking care of your staff, the importance of taking care of yourself, the importance of modeling taking care of yourself to everybody under you. But I can assure you, as someone who has been in this biz a long time, that most people don't do it. Most of the leaders don't do it. Most of the senior leaders don't do it. Most of the junior leaders don't do it. Most of the staff don't do it. When they're in that thing, they revert to those primitive things that we talked about a minute ago. They have their tantrums, they yell at their staff, they say it, they pull their all-nighters, they drink coffee, they do whatever it takes. Now, that's always out of a good place, right? People want to do the right thing, they want to help. It's a crisis situation, we want to respond to it. But it turns out most of us really ignore the evolved coping, the evolved leadership, and instead we do the primitive stuff. And there's reasons for that in neuroscience, right? You've got to re-engage sort of the cognitive part of your brain. Anything that forces you to stop and think is going to engage that part of your brain, and it's going to improve your problem solving and your decision making. So there's lots of tools, and we've heard about some of them today, and I'll just close, sure my time is, but I'll close, by just talking about one tool that we have available. Not the be-all and end-all, but again, I think any tool that forces you to access your actual decision-making, the higher-level cortical part of your brain, that's what you really need to do as a leader in a disaster. You need to not be on autopilot. Because as soon as you're on autopilot, you increase the likelihood of making poor decisions, of you know being under stress, and then of having your own negative outcomes, right? Whether it's being fired, or having a heart attack, or just being super stressed all the time, and yelling at your family, whatever it is. We don't want those outcomes, right? We want outcomes that are good for the individual and for the community. So, what we do is we have this program called Psychological First Aid for Leaders. So, built on some of the things we've talked about, but what it really is a training program that you can find online that teaches you how to use those basic human skills that just help you get along with people, but using them in a disaster as a leader. So, you're running an operations center in a disaster. What do you do to use those kind of soft skills to manage your people and to manage yourself? And it's kind of a cool training because it takes you through these different, you know, scenarios. So you can be running a policy office in a disaster, you could be running an EOC during a disaster, you could be running sort of a medical countermeasures research thing during a disaster. You can find it, you know, PHE is the ASTER website, which stands for Public Health Emergency, phe.gov/ABC. That's my website, and you can find it there. But I'm really not actually here to promote a website or a training. It's a great training. Psychological First Aid for Leaders. It's 6 hours. It's multi-modular, so you can kind of take it in pieces if you want. You'll learn a lot from doing it. You'll learn a lot from any of the trainings. BMAC has got great stuff. The National Center has got training. But I think the key thing is you have to engage the part of your brain that isn't automatic. You have to disengage all the... Now, some stuff you got to be able to do automatically, right? But the problem is when we get on autopilot during disasters, we often make decisions that aren't good for us in the long term. So what we want to do is we want to engage that cognitive, higher-level thinking through using these basic skills. And in doing that, then I think we take the time to do the self-care, to do the things that we've been talking about. Otherwise, we don't. And then we end up having people who have really, really serious, I mean, as you all probably know, I mean, we've got people in the long-term recovery right now who are experiencing very significant and even sometimes fatal health conditions because we're not taking care of ourselves or our people as well as we should. And that's what crisis leadership is all about, right? It's about making the right decisions and taking care of the people who work for you so that you can all work together to promote the recovery.
So our last panel will have some time for questions. I have to admit my thrill at, because I'm an academic geek at heart, and any discussion that degenerates into neurocognitive behavior and issues of free will, I just get so excited. But let's go on to questions. Do we have questions from the audience?
Dr. Coggins, this is really for you, sir. What leaders have you studied or observed, and you don't have to name them by names, but maybe what sort of things did you notice about the way they weren't taking care of themselves or not engaging that kind of part of your brain? Have you studied these things, or is it mostly an academic? Have you seen them, or what does that look like?
So I think, again, a lot of the research in this area, of course, is done through expert interviews, right? I mean, it's hard to, you can't do a randomized, you know, controlled study on you know, the behavior of people during disasters because, of course, it's, you know, it's kind of happening on an ad hoc basis. But I think there are a number of works out there, and I can get you some citations later, for people who have responded successfully to disasters. Again, I think the trick, though, is to find folks who walk the talk because, again, we've heard from great people today, and obviously, Admiral Allen and others, I think, have written about this, have talked about it, and have given great examples. But I think it's also important to kind of observe the people around you, because I think we do have leaders who are often not in the spotlight and often not getting a lot of attention, even in the command structure. I think it's important to just talk to them and find out sort of who their role models and heroes are. Because I think it's going to vary a lot. But I think in general, obviously, again, Admiral Allen has talked about this a lot, and I think that there also are some good case studies that have looked at, you know, people like Rudy Giuliani and others at sort of what they did well and what they didn't. So I would refer you to some of the case studies in the literature.
Can I follow along with that real quick? I understand that, you know, Mike Brown was mentioned, and he wasn't invited today. I don't know his story or whatever, but have you and this academic side gone to those folks who maybe didn't get invited to a serum, a place like this, and say, hey, what are those differences? You know, we can all tell that Admiral Allen did a fantastic job. We can read about those things, but there's the other side of that coin. Are we not laying there?
Yeah, I think I don't know the answer to that. I do think it's an important and actually an empirical question. We always interview the people that we perceive to have been successful, and we don't often, I mean, we do lessons learned, But I think we actually don't do a good job of capturing sort of lessons learned from leaders who were not perceived to be successful. I don't know if other folks have comments.
I would say you're right. Unfortunately, a lot of the people who don't lead successfully are not the ones who get to talk about their experiences or what they learned about themselves and how they would improve. But what I've seen in the field in emergency management with nonprofits and local, county, state levels is that when you have a good 360 after action report and you allow the people who are underneath those leaders to give honest feedback about what was wrong, how they would have liked it done differently, that's where you can really get the positives out of the negatives. I mean, I think the lessons learned are so important, and so allowing your team to be able to talk about what those lessons could be and how we can move forward to do something better in the next phase is vital.
I think we do have opportunities sometimes. In the case of the first week of Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans, we can see where some of those decisions came from before the admiral took charge. And it's in congressional testimony in that case, so it's on the record. The example you gave of somebody who was making bad decisions did not have the technical knowledge about how they should be behaving. And in that particular case, they threw out the Federal Response Plan, which was what all the organizations had practiced on, and made up a new decision. That's generally not a very good strategy. I think understanding the technical knowledge of the area in which you're supposed to be working, as opposed to purely political appointees, is a very serious kind of issue. And we see this also in terms of some of the things, such as the hospital staff that we work with, and talking about, you know, what do you need to know about how do you manage the stress you deal with every day. And if you haven't talked about it, if you haven't thought about it, it's more difficult to manage that stressful situation.
And let me just add, last year's crisis solution meeting, we had Leonard Marcus from the Harvard MBLI, National Leadership Institute, and that organization, if you go to their website, has a lot of case studies. That's one of the things they do. They go and they dissect specific events and stuff. So it's worth going to those articles for answers. Other questions?
Good morning. Thank you. We've heard a lot of interesting stories of personal experiences and strategies for dealing with the well-being and mental health. And I'm wondering, from a systems perspective, if you have any thoughts about what agencies or institutions can do to promote well-being among its leaders.
Let me just repeat the question. The question was, from a systems perspective, what can agencies and organizations do to improve mental health of their people?
I think from a systems perspective, I think you really have to take it all the way back to the level of resources and personnel. Because I think what happens very often in disasters is we do exhaust our bench pretty quickly. And I think, now certainly, we do get into a kind of competitive thing in the disaster world, also true in the medical world too, of, you know, I was up 12 hours, well, I was up 20, well, I was up 40, you know, it almost becomes a competitive victimization thing, like who's suffered more, who's stayed up longer, who's missed more meals with their family. It almost becomes a badge of honor. We have to do away with that. It can't be a badge of honor to neglect yourself. However, systemically, we have to have benches, right? Because if you only got one epidemiologist in your county health department, that person may have to work 24 hours, you know, right? I mean, you've got to have the resources, you've got to have employees who can do different functions so that you can give your people breaks and other people can back them up. And I think that's a huge systemic problem, is if we don't have the personnel, then how are we going to give people a respite that they
do think that's important, and indeed, part of the way that I have felt comfortable leaving at the end of my shift in major disasters is trusting the colleague who has taken over for me. In the case of the Red Cross, for instance, when Red Cross developed disaster mental health, began in 1991, November of 1991, one of the first things that we wound up doing, and it wasn't really in our job description, none of us anticipated it, was working with management to have better environments for the Red Cross volunteers to work. And at that point, they were recruiting people coming out working 12, 15 hour shifts for 21 days, and then they were sent home, and good luck to them when they got home. We encouraged them, based on empirical research and industrial models, to give people breaks, to give them days off after a certain number of days, to require them to take breaks, and the administration initially said, no, that'll cost way too much, except that when they actually tried it, it cost less because fewer of their workers had to be sent home early because of difficulty in coping or illness. And so when they started taking care of themselves, it made a real difference. The one hospital system we work with, after testing the psychological, community-based psychological first aid model, for several rounds, made a decision that every employee in the hospital system had to be trained in mutual psychological support. And that made a tremendous difference in their turnover, and people feeling happier in their jobs, et cetera, et cetera. So there are systemic issues that are involved.
I would say ditto to everything. As well as, I would like to point out some of the things that were brought up in previous presenters, which was this idea of the daily briefings. Those are something that can be instituted within your organization and is actually very psychologically supportive by having multiple briefings every day to let people know that it, one, establishes the routine, but also, two, allows them to ask the tough questions and reassert what the mission is. And those things all help with the staff morale as well as staff psychologically. I would also say, when it comes to these breaks, one of the good things that you can do within your organization or your institution is to identify a location away from the chaos for people to take breaks. A place where they can go where it's quiet, they can do their self-care techniques, they can get a water, coffee, or food. Having those things set up away where they can vent with their colleagues, honestly, because a lot of times when you want to talk about it and that supervisor standing next to you, you're not going to talk about how horrible they are or how tough it is to work with the patients that you're working with if they're right there. So those are just a couple. And I would say that the training that Dr. Dodgen said actually incorporates a lot of this. And you could list on all of those slides all of the different ways to incorporate psychological care within your plans and your organization.
I have a question. It's a little bit of a specialized question, but coming from a disaster medical and public health responder, I think there's particularly acute stressors on those providing health care. Because in those situations, it's the only time in our lives we're faced with a lack of resources. And we talk about altered standards of care. Do you guys have any comments about how we can help disaster health, mental health, public health providers through those issues?
It is really tough, and I'll just talk about one tiny little aspect of it, which is going back to the psychological preparedness. A lot of the trainings that I do are with healthcare professionals, being at the VA, and this particular training that we worked on was geared specifically for healthcare professionals and public health. And one of the things that we encourage is to think through beforehand, what will your environment look like and how will it change? There was this wonderful example after the terrible incident in Las Vegas, the Las Vegas shootings. They were interviewing a hospital who had responded and taken the majority of trauma patients, and they said that one of the ER doctors who was working there, he was notorious for having going around to all the staff and saying, what if this happened right now? And where would you go? What would you do? What is your role? What if you didn't have that supply? Okay, right now we have 100 patients. What are you going to do? And he talked them through this over and over, so when the actual event happened, he was the first one to say, okay, we all got this. We know what we're going to do, and we're going to do it well. And he was standing at the door waiting for the first ambulance. So it's again going back to thinking through, well, how will my role change? How will the environment change? What will my resources look like so that I can get myself emotionally ready, because I know that I won't be able to be physically ready with some of those supplies.
I agree very much. It's a question of preparedness. A number of years ago, the Centers for Disease Control issued their first pamphlet on psychological preparedness. It was focused on pandemic events. And they sent it to me and they asked me to review it. And one of the things it said was, you know, in the midst of the pandemic, we need to have the physicians and the nurses take off and do psychological first aid training. And I called my representative at CDC and said, so in the midst of people dying everywhere around you and overwhelming numbers of people coming in with this whatever it is disease, you're going to then stop and step out of that situation, stop caring for patients and take training. I don't think so. I said, oh, do you think we should make the preparations?
One thing I just add, I had the dubious privilege of spending some time in Toronto during the SARS epidemic, which hopefully most people in the room remember. And for those of you in the healthcare profession, you probably remember that the worst psychological outcomes for like any group was healthcare professionals in that epidemic. And that was because of a lot of the things that and I don't know if anyone was there, but you know, if you went into the hospitals, they were like literally almost like a sandwich board around you, you know, saying visitor, patients, you know, healthcare professional, whatever. But because of the nature and the way that it was transmitted, basically physicians and nurses and all the healthcare professionals were very isolated. They weren't going home, they weren't doing grand rounds. So what happened was they basically, the healthcare staff were completely isolated from each other as well as from their normal social support. So you ended up with the worst mental health outcomes for the very people that were providing the care. So I think one of the things we have to be really, really attentive to with all of our healthcare providers is that they also have needs for interaction with colleagues to, you know, not necessarily grand rounds, but something that like allows you to talk about cases. They got to be able to interact with their families and feel safe in doing that. And they also, of course, need the respite and all the other things. And so I think we're better at that than we used to be, but I don't think we're as good as we could be in recognizing some of the unique things, particularly in, you know, an infectious disease scenario where healthcare providers may be, potentially become vectors, right? So we need to be thinking, I think, more about that.
And just to note that current technology makes it easier to stay in touch with your families. Just have to remind you to do it.
Any last questions? Okay, we'll move over to our final speaker. I'm going to thank our panel. I'll briefly introduce Dr. Flynn, but I'll let him introduce himself. Dr. Brian Flynn is a retired rear admiral from the Public Health Service and has been really, frankly, the, or at least one of the major leading drivers in the whole development of disaster mental health for the last 20 years. And so it's good that we have him available to us to kind of give summary statements about this.
Thanks, Tom. Tom indicated, I've been in the field of disaster behavioral health for a long time. A lot of it, most of it, in terms of my actual field work, was when I was in the public health service and got involved in all kinds of disasters and all kinds of places. Sometimes when I half joke that I spent my career going to the nicest places at the worst possible times. That's what I did. I learned a lot during that period. My training did not prepare me for that kind of work. I think that would be true of most of us if we were candid about it. This kind of work is very different. How we apply what we've learned to very novel, different kinds of situations is quite a challenge. One of the things that I learned through all those years is that leadership matters. I can't tell you how many disasters I worked on where good leadership made the difference in terms of a very powerful positive response, and the vice versa, where leadership failed and the entire response failed. I also learned as a subset of that, that at least part of that success or failure had to do with how leaders managed their own stress and promoted their own psychological well-being. That was a big factor in the success or failure of the operation. I also experienced that personally. I am very willing to admit that there were a couple of times where I really became a psychological casualty because of not being able to manage my stress successfully. And I saw firsthand my production, my productivity, the quality of my work go down. I also saw times when I was better able to manage those kinds of things, and I think it actually contributed dramatically to positive accomplishments there. So that was one of the things, that experience is what got me so excited about collaborating with our colleagues here and our speakers on trying to address this kind of issue because we don't often talk about it. As I listened and thought about what kinds of summary statements to make here, like any good symposium with good people, it just raises more exciting and difficult questions than answers. So I thought maybe in conclusion what I would do is try to identify some of those areas where I think we need to do continued work or new work based on the data that we've heard today. There's the first kind of set of those issues I've labeled where does this topic fit? Because it's not an easy natural fit with other kinds of things. I think you know we talk an awful lot in disaster behavioral health about victim and survivor stress. During my career, we have learned a great deal about how that manifests itself and what are the protective factors and risk factors. We've done well, and we always need to do more. We also talk quite a bit about responders. Stress, and we're learning more about that. But we don't talk much or write much or think much about leadership stress. So I think one of the challenges is to find out and to tease out what are the similarities and differences. There's clearly overlap in some of this, but there's also some very important distinct differences. And I think a good challenge for us is try to understand where those similarities and differences lie. I think a similar kind of analysis is going to be helpful when we look at different kind of contexts, the natural disaster context, the human-caused disaster context, the war context, the accidental technological kind of situation. Again, there are overlaps, I'm convinced, but I think there are also some significant differences that have to do with different leadership skills, maybe different ways of managing stress and promoting health. What about those kinds of events that arise instantaneously that nobody could anticipate versus those that arise over time and we have lots of time to prepare? Maybe there are differences in leadership stress and well-being issues there. I'm glad that Tom mentioned the work of Lenny Marcus, and he gave an extraordinary presentation last year here. And he does a better job than anybody I can think of in terms of really studying leadership issues in extreme situations and being able to communicate challenge. I also was very struck by Admiral Allen's comments about how we're doing all this in a very different world than we've ever been in, where this pace of change is so dramatic and the globalization of impact is so dramatic. That's not something I thought much about when I started in this field, but I think if we don't appreciate and think about the implications of that and the fact that we will always be behind the curve because of that speed. That's a very different environment to work in. So that's a very different context. So those are the contextual things I was thinking about. The other category of things that I thought might be worth further thinking about is how do we develop new knowledge in this field, and how do we better or best apply what we already know? And there are several kinds of areas that I think we might want to think about, and all of them have been touched on today. One is research. What do we know? How do we know it? What's our level of confidence in what we know? And what kinds of new research should we be doing in this area? And what type of research should that be? Is that applied research? Is that psychological research? You know, because I'm working in this environment in the Department of Psychiatry, I've gotten much greater appreciation than I had before of biological and neurological kinds of issues. Maybe there's some answers and some interesting questions to be asked there. The second area is education and training. How can we incorporate these topics that we've heard about today in academic training, ongoing education of professionals of all kinds? How do we infuse this in existing training capacities? That it was very exciting to hear particularly Jerry and Dan talk about, you know, some of the new psychological first aid for leaders and things. That's wonderful. You could only have hoped for that kind of thing earlier in my career. I think that's just the start. I was also struck with some of the topics that we heard today, and was sort of wondering how we might better incorporate those in training and education, specifically things about modeling. That came out as a very important factor in several of our presentations. Well, how do we teach that? Because that may be a whole different skill set, but something other that we don't talk about much in terms of leadership. And we also heard some things about world conflict. I think that, in my experience, has been something that we probably don't talk enough about and prepare people for. When I first joined the National Institute of Mental Health working in disaster work, one of the first things I was involved with was a request from FEMA that asked us to do a report on world conflict. And that makes sense unless you realize, as most of you do, we don't often think about it, that FEMA then and now isn't just disaster response. It has a major continuity of government, kind of the dark side of things that people talk about lots of times. What they really wanted to know at the bottom of that request is, with all the continuity of government plans that are in place, will people actually play their professional role, or will they play their family role? Really good question. I think those questions are relevant today. We do have some data on those kinds of things. But certainly in my experience, how we manage those, that role conflict is important. It's a huge issue in the military, as I've gotten into this environment. That's the basis of a lot of military stress and family stress, is how does one fulfill an occupational role but still value and honor family roles and the tensions that come with that. The risk of being accused of shameless self-promotion. I edited a book that came out about it valuable contributors are myself, I think one of the most powerful chapters in that book was written by Albert Ashley, who was the director of the Oklahoma Department of Emergency Management during the, at the time of the Oklahoma City bombing, and he continues in that role today. He talks about what it was like to be the lead state emergency manager there at the same time his sister-in-law was killed in the building. What it's like to be an administrator, a leader, at the same time that you were a victim and a family member. And if you want an eloquent description of the challenges of global conflict, I think that's one of them. So that was touched on today, but I think it's a powerful part of leadership stress in these kinds of environments. I was delighted to hear the systems question and policy questions. You're sick of myself there. One of my beliefs for a long time is that we can do a lot to eliminate, reduce, and manage stress just by the way we organize our response, by the way we administer our programs. It's not often thought about as an intervention. But you know, looking at policies and procedures and what we expect people to do and what we limit people in doing is a critical part. It's not something we often talk about. It's not sexy, it's not exciting. But what it does is when you look at those kinds of things, you can see the values, the core values of an organization. And that gets to what any of you who have been hanging around me for any period of time know how powerful I think the influence of organizational culture is on everything we do, and especially in disasters. People know whether you give a damn about them or not. And lots of times, how we view employees, how we view management, how we view leadership, really is reflected in the organizational culture, and I think that makes a huge difference. So I think looking at how we design and integrate systems, how we organize responses in terms of systems approach, policies, and operations are critical parts of this. I'd also mention that I think one of the challenges, exciting challenges for us, is cross-organizational and professional boundaries. I think there is a lot we can learn from each other. I think that developing that book on integration of emergency management and disaster behavior health was a very good example of that. These are two very different organizational cultures looking at the same issue through different lenses. And the more we can understand the lenses through which everybody else looks at things versus the way we do, the more exciting, creative, and innovative kinds of collaborations that we can have. Again, I guess I would end by saying that I think the last and I think one of the critical challenges for us moving forward is how do we promote and sustain organization and professional cultures that view the psychosocial health of leaders as a core value.